like Jehovah's Witnesses. $300 of all the witnesses. They sitting down, we standing on business. Hey, standing on business. Standing on business. I'm geeking hard, I'm always a tank. Don't know what I took. My doggy got booked for acting like book. You shot him in. Shot him in daylight. Like what's in your shoe? We sock it. Like what's in your wrist? We cock it. Like anyone home? We watch it. The clubs here, we drop it. Like Lenny Kravitz show, we rock it. Like tennis indoors, we squash it. Like combo number one, we watch it. Shot him in. What? Shot him in daylight.
Now taking the field for UNLV in left field, number 8, Santino Panaro. In center field, number 25, Rylan Charles. In right field, number 14, Cade Higgins. At third base, number 1, Isaac Rodriguez. At shortstop, number 3, Paul Miro, the 4th. At second base, number 5, J.P. Heck. At first base, number 47, Austin Krizik. The catcher, number 20, Bailey Seeger. And on the mound for the Hustlin' Rebels, number 12, Noah Carbajal. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, we ask that you please rise if you're able, remove your hats, and face the flag with your right hand over your heart for this evening's playing of our national anthem.
From Earl E. Wilson Stadium here on the campus of UNLV, this is another edition of Hustlin' Rebels Baseball. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Earl. Along with Dan Dolby, I'm Matt Neverett, bringing you the first of a brief two-game midweek non-conference showdown between UNLV and the visiting St. Mary's Gales out of the WCC. UNLV enters into the matchup 10-8, while St. Mary's comes in with a nearly identical 10-6 mark on the year. Rebels coming off of a two-game split this weekend against another WCC foe in Santa Clara. UNLV 6-3 here at Earl E. Wilson Stadium, and they'll throw Noah Carbajal on the hill tonight. The 6'2", 200-pounder out of Palo Verde High School here in Las Vegas starts against this St. Mary's team that has had a lot of success in recent years in the WCC. Eric Valenzuela, the 7th-year head coach, also with experience top to bottom in the lineup this afternoon. Rebels, after the two-game split against Santa Clara, have Carbajal on the hill without a decision on the year. A 3.86 earned run average for the right-hander. Two games, one start this year. He's thrown 4 2/3 innings, allowing 2 runs on 4 hits. 2 strikeouts to a walk, although opponents batting just .235 against him. And after a year last year where Carbajal was a featured weekend starter, trying to find his way back into the rotation with a good start tonight.
You know, this is an opportunity for the Rebels to start building some consistency. We've seen them up, we've seen them down. There's times when the offense is doing really well, pitching is a little lacking, and then the defense seems to give up a little bit more than we're used to. Coach Stolte and his staff are going to be looking for consistency to these next couple days so that they can roll into the Reno Conference Series next weekend, try to get some momentum going.
Rebels hitting .306 as a team, but to your point, Dan, a .631 earned run average for UNLV so far on the year. St. Mary's, as mentioned, led by seventh year head man Eric Valenzuela. We have Gavin Napier leading things off, the second baseman, ready to get it started. The only left-hander in the lineup, Christian Almanza, the big-bodied first baseman, hit second with Ryan Pierce batting and playing at third. Coleman Schmidt, the right fielder in the cleanup spot. Brian Duroff in left field batting fifth. Dalton Mayshore playing in center field out of the sixth spot. The DH, Nathan Chong, followed by the freshman catcher, Connor Bear Harrison. Jared Medem, the shortstop, rounds out the lineup for St. Mary's. Carbajal out of the full wind, and his first pitch inside starts this one off at 6:06 here in the West Coast. 70 degrees, no wind to speak of as the game gets going. 1-0, missing just off the inside, called for ball two by Ryan Wilson behind home plate. The crew chief, Jeffrey Macias, down the first baseline. Jim Courtney across from him at third. Anthony Prater rounds out the quartet of umpires, currently in right center field as he watches a pitch off the outside from Carbajal, starting behind Napier 3-0, working with some tempo as he throws low for ball four. A four-pitch walk to start the game, the second walk in nearly five innings on the year for Carbajal, and the Gales with a runner on to start, and not the way you want to get it going with Christian Almanza, as dangerous a hitter as it comes, not only on this team, Dan, but in the WCC coming up next.
Yeah, Almanza hitting .400, so going from the left side of the plate, so he's got a favorable matchup against a right-handed Carbajal, and Carbajal's got to find the plate.
Out of the stretch, Carbajal. The pitch swung on and crushed deep to right field. Back goes Higgins. Right fielder's going to watch it clear the fence. Five pitches into the game. A walk followed by a long ball. Have St. Mary's on top, 2-0, just like that, on Almanza's team-leading ninth home run of the season.
This is very similar to Carby's last start here last week, where he gave up two early runs, settled down as the innings went on, but Rebels weren't able to come back from the deficit early. Carby with no strikes actually thrown, other than the home run ball given up to Almanza, gonna have to settle in here real quick.
Nobody on, nobody out for Ryan Pierce as the first baseman cuts on at a slider and misses, trying to jump all over the first pitch following the home run by Almanza. Almanza now with 24 runs batted in on the year. Pierce hitting .299 in the campaign. Checks his swing on a slider, bouncing down and away. He appealed down to first, and no, he did not, says Jeffrey Macias. Count goes even at one.
With some of the new pitching that is coming in this year for the Rebels, Carby and a couple other guys, Acosta, they're looking for their roles that they're going to play this year as that ball misses low and outside. They got to find their home, but this isn't a good start to get good graces with the pitching coach, Corey Vanderhoof.
Foul ball poked out of plate on the right field side. Pierce behind the ball in two strikes, hitting .299, four home runs, 18 batted in on the campaign. Pierce, the 6'4" sophomore corner infielder, transfer from Fresno State. 2-2, the ball spins the slider off the outside, and the count goes full. Waiting on deck is Coleman Schmidt, the right fielder. Bailey Seeger doing the catching tonight, filling up the batter here in the top of the first inning. Payoff pitch from Carbajal, swung on and missed for strike three.
First strike ladies and gentlemen, that first strikeout of the game brought to you by Belfort Restoration.
Carbajal with a good comeback following the long ball here in the first.
Yeah, absolutely. You settled in right there through real quality pitches. Offerings up to the plate right there, mixed things up, a fastball, came back with a couple breaking balls, another fastball, and then ended up that slider able to strike him out. So hopefully that's a sign of good things to come for Carbs.
Right fielder Coleman Schmidt in from the right with one out, nobody on. Carbajal, who had a bunch of success against Pierce with the slider, starts on Schmidt with the same, going backwards to the cleanup hitter. Schmidt out of Reno, adding in the cleanup spot for the Gales. 5-3 on the road this year. And Schmidt takes a strike. Another slider going back to the well. There's Carbajal.
Big hitter Almanza for the Gales. Ball left the park off the bat at 108 miles an hour.
You think he was ready for that first pitch fastball?
He was sitting on that one.
Schmidt takes a pitch in the dirt.
Which, Carbs threw four straight balls, so he saw something he liked and he wasn't going to be cheated.
Yeah, 9 times out of 10, that's an auto take, especially to the leadoff hitter of a game. The 1-2. Called for strike three. Fastball freezes Schmidt on the outside. Back-to-back K's following the Almanza blast. And with a 2-0 lead and two outs, nobody out, Brian Durant is going to get next for the game.
Sure be easier to walk back into the dugout to talk to Coach Vanderhook if Carps can come out and strike out the side here after giving up those two quick ones. Make him feel a lot better about himself, too.
Durant, a 298 hitter on the year. Launches a first pitch slider for a strike. So that's been the recipe to the next three batters following the Almanza bombs. Just go right with the breaking pitch off the bat. Out of the full wind, the 0-1. Down and away. Austin Krizek batting first base today. JP Heft up the middle at second with Paul Miro at short, his double play partner. Isaac Rodriguez getting the start at third base. Santino Panaro in left. Ryland Charles in center. Kate Higgins in his customary right field. Count out 2-1. Missing down and a bit off the outside. There was Carbajal. Doing the DHing this evening. Parker Schmidt for Stan Stolte and company. That pitch to the backstop, and Duroff now ahead. 3-0.
Yeah, Carvey starts off with a good breaking ball right there. Next two sliders are in the dirt and overthrows a fastball there. So he's going to have to battle back here at 3-1 count.
Out of the full windup, he misses low for ball four. That was a fastball. Carbajal not having a lot of luck with that straight pitch thus far tonight. Second walk of the inning is his third of the year in over five innings. And Dalton Mayshore, the next Gale due up. You mentioned, Dan, that last outing for Carbajal. Here at home on the fifth, 2 weeks ago today against BYU, Carbajal gave up 2 runs on 4 hits, 2 of those hits home runs. Lasted 3 2/3 innings, took a no decision in a 6-4 Hustlin' Rebel defeat. Carbajal out of the stretch for the second time. It's a foul ball knocked straight back by Mayshore, going with the slider again.
Yeah, he's confident in that pitch right now. So he may just, until he gets kind of his feet underneath him with that fastball. Heavy of breaking balls isn't a bad thing right now against the Gales.
He's been locating that spinning pitch as well. There's the fastball here, the snap throw back to first base. Not in time. Krizek able to get back to the base, sliding back in head first and safely is Duroff.
Good strong throw by Seager. Had to come up out of his crouch to get that high fastball. That ball is away from the first base bag towards the dugout, so it's a tough tag.
This one's popped up, foul ground down the first base side. Krizek makes a move to the fence, but runs out of room. Foul ball. Moves the count to 1-2.
What a beautiful night for baseball.
Couldn't ask for anything better. Yeah, we've been fortunate here on the spring equinox. Winter is over, although the cold weather has been gone from Southern Nevada for quite some time now.
I'm ready for some heat back here in the desert.
Yeah, let's do it. Better golf weather. Here's the 1-2 from Carbajal. Right-hander center the belt. Kicks and deals. Fastball just upstairs. That'll even the count at deuces wide. 2-0 on a Christian Almanza. 2-run blast after a 4-pitch walk to lead off the game. Back-to-back strikeouts followed by a walk here in the top of the first. Mayshore, an open stance, stares down Carbajal. Here's the 2-2. Runner goes. Slider called outside. Beautiful throw from Seager. And the tag applied in plenty of time by J.P. Heff. Caught stealing 2-4. Ends with a 2-run, 1-hit. Top of the first inning. There were no errors and nobody left on base. Almanza has the game separated for now. 2-0. St. Mary's leads it after a half an inning of play. Ryland Charles leads things off against
the Rebel fans. It's 2-for-1 Rebel Dogs night over at Smoke and Sam's concession stand. So head on over while supplies last. We want to thank Smoke and Sam's for their continued support of the program.
Yeah.
due up for the first time here on the home half of the first inning.
The center fielder, number
Charles
25,
Lee sings out for UNLV, St. Mary's. On top of the big, Michelle Moss will blast away.
If you really want to see the beautiful frame.
Madonna's College in California, 1-2 with an 8.41 ERA. Look to bring that down against the Rebels team that bats 306 as a unit to this point. First pitch, high and tight to Rylan Charles, called for strike one. Rylan leading things off at a 263 average, three homers, 13 batted in. Third baseman Ryan Pierce creeps in front of the bag as Charles slaps a ground ball to second. Picked up on one hop by Gavin Napier, and his throw to Almanza at first is in time. Charles
that
taps out second
second baseman.
As the second baseman, J.P. Hempstead's in, will set the batting lineup for Stan Stolte. Following J.P. Hempstead, third baseman Isaac Rodriguez, who's getting the spot start. Kate Higginson right in the cleanup spot, wants to cruise it. He's carrying five-hole batting spot. Playing at first base, Parker Schmidt doing the DH and getting sixth. Santino Panaro in left, Bailey Seeger doing the catching. And Paul Meyer the fourth. Rounds out the starting nine for Stan Stolte, playing at short. Heff takes a strike. He hasn't taken many, 375 average with a really aggressive approach. One home run, 14 batted in. As Heft lines this one to the gap in right center field. That's down for a base hit. Center fielder made sure over to the gap to pick it up, limiting Heft to his 28th hit on the year. On the UNLV roster has four hits for J.P. Heft so far.
Yeah, we keep talking about J.P. Heft. The defense is playing at second base, but that bat has just been absolutely on fire for him. And again, we talked about him today. I would say more than half of his hit are opposite field hits. So he's a guy that can move the ball around based on what he's receiving at the plate.
Wouldn't pick that one up off the shoe tops for sure. Here's Isaac Rodriguez, who takes a first pitch strike from Lynchy, who in his five previous outings had lasted 20 and a third innings. He had been knocked around, no other way to put it. 29 hits, seven of them home runs, and charged for 19 earned runs with a 337 batting average against. Rodriguez swings and fouls one off the hand of the catcher, Connor Harrison. Called the Bear. Bear Harrison behind home plate, the 6'2" first-year player. Middle infield made up of Napier at second. Jared Medham, the shortstop. The outfield left to right for St. Mary's. Brian Duroff, Dalton Mayshore, and Colton Smith. Nathan Chong doing the DH and batting seventh. He'll hit second in the top of the second inning. 2-0, St. Mary's on top. 0-2 Rodriguez down the chute, called for strike three. For strikeout for Lynchy on the day.
Right,
he's 16th of the year.
For some reason, we haven't been able to confirm why yet, but St. Mary's, their series last weekend was canceled.
As Higgins swings and misses at strike one. Yeah, they had not played in 11 days, although they took on the number four Florida Gators, so they may have needed some time off to recuperate after dropping 2-3. Change up fades outside as Higgins evens up the count at a ball and a strike. Cade, a 371 average. One home run, still surprising, Dan. He's only got 9 RBIs to this point.
Yeah, but he's hitting for average.
It's this one up the middle on the ground. Yeah, okay. Sneaks past the second baseman Napier. Rounding second and zooming to third is Heft. Right fielder Schmidt fires it into the base at second. A two-base advancement for J.P. Heft. On Kate Higgins, 27th hit of the year. He's one behind Heft for the team lead. Central runners in the corner with 2 down.
You brought the point. He's not hitting for a lot of RBI right now. But he is getting on base. And that's been key for the Rebels and their success early this season.
He is hitting for extra bases, Higgins. 11 of his now 27 hits have been for multiple bags. Brings up Austin Krizek in an RBI spot, although they'll need to record a hit with 2 down to drive him in. Watching all the way on a first pitch fastball call for a strike.
Lynchy's got a really smooth motion. Doesn't look like he's putting a lot of effort, and we're going to try to get some metrics on his pitch velocity here shortly, but he's got a good motion to him.
The 0-1 out of the stretch, swung on and popped up down the right field side. That'll find the seats and push it, nothing at 2.
Dangers of foul balls coming into the
last time out for Lynchy was on the 9th of March. He threw 7 innings against top 5 team in Florida. Gave up 3 runs on 5 hits. Took the win in a quality start. The only game that St. Mary's claimed from the Gators. Runner goes from first. Krizek pops it foul and out of play on the right field side.
Anytime you go into Gainesville and get a win down the SEC, then you got to put that feather in your cap.
Especially this time of year, is St. Mary's yet to play a conference game. The WCC has their conference matchups late. Most recent game for the Gales was actually against a Mountain West team. Tuesday of last week, a week ago today, they were at San Jose State and won 7-1. Krizik puts it through the right side of the infield for a base hit. Heff scores from third, and the Rebels on the board. It's a 2-1 game here in the bottom of the first. It's a ticket that advances up to six.
Good piece of hit right there behind the dugout. Or just take something out over the plate, drives into the opposite field, easily scoring the run. Higgins got to hold up because the ball was hit too deep in the right field. Right fielder Schmidt was able to come up with that pretty quickly. But nonetheless, Rebels get on the board.
Parker Schmidt looks to tie the game with a base hit. Stands in now as the DH this evening. It's a fastball down the chute for strike one. Three hits already for the Rebels. It took them until the fifth inning to record their third hit in a 9-5 loss in their most recent game on Sunday against Santa Clara.
Day before, it took them four innings to get their first hit.
Already better offense here this week as Schmidt leans away from a fastball inside. It's a called strike. He disagrees, but the count goes nothing and two. Higgins on second, Krizik on first after his team-leading 25th run batted in on a single. Second baseman Nate Pierce shaded up the middle as Schmidt takes a fastball just off the outside. Harrison sure thought it was strike three behind the dish.
Yeah, the big bear behind the dish thought that was a strike. You talked about Connor Bear Harrison. Once we see a name like that, we look at the lineup, the roster, and see what the actual size is on it. He's got the size.
Yeah, 6'3" catcher. Hard to come by these days. Schmidt lines one to left. That's down for a base hit. Getting the waiver on third is Higgins. He'll be in without a throw as Duroff fires to the base at third. Nobody's home. Here comes Krizik to third base. And advancing up to second is Parker Schmidt. An RBI base hit followed by a throwing error from the left fielder Duroff. And this one's tied at two here in the bottom of the first inning.
The left fielder, Schmidt, number eight, Santino.
Taking advantage of his opportunities. Every time that we've seen him hit his opportunities throughout the year, he's taken advantage of them.
It was
a good hit right there. He was going to score early. We're going to get a mountain visit already. As the one thing that's interesting about that play, as the ball was hit out to the left field, Brian Duroff came up throwing. The bag should have been covered. He's going to be responsible for the error, but somebody's got to be on that bag. Either the pitcher or the third baseman, but the third baseman went out into the dirt, just off the dirt to cut it off. So pitcher's got to get over and cover it. Unfortunately, Duroff's going to get the error on that one.
And you would think that then a good part of this mountain visit is making sure that the infield knows their assignments.
And I'm not sure where shortstop was heading at that point either. It looked like he was breaking back towards the bag, or second base bag.
Yeah, no, and then when the shortstop should be the cutoff to third. Third should be the cutoff to the plate.
Correct.
In that case, there was nobody anywhere near the bag.
No.
So that moves Krizik to third. Up to second is Schmidt. Here's Santino Pinaro, who waves and misses over a first pitch strike. He was trying to do some damage on that swing for sure.
Not a power hitter, but that was a power swing.
Pinaro, one of three left-handed hitters in the lineup tonight for Stan Stolte. With Bailey Seager on deck. Two on, two down. As Lynchy steps off, fakes a throw to third. Nobody anywhere near Austin Krizik. He had a short lead as well. Schmidt behind him at second. Nobody keeping an eye on Schmidt up the middle. Nothing and one. Lynchy delivers. Pinaro pops it up. Shallow to left center. Heading back is Meadow. Shortstop called off by the left fielder Duroff at the last moment. He gloves it for out number three. But the Rebels tie the game up. Able to score two runs on four hits. There was one error in the inning. And a pair of hustling Rebels left on base through one inning four. We're back where we started. All tied up. It's a 2-2 game.
You're going to be a part of your Las Vegas life. And more importantly, you're going to help you live an even healthier life.
Thank you.
Hitting off the top of the second for St. Mary's, the center fielder, number 3, Dalton Mayshore.
UNLV Baseball brought to you by Intermountain Health, here to be a part of your Las Vegas life. More importantly, here to help you live an even healthier one. Intermountain Health, official health partner of UNLV Athletics. Noah Carbajal back out for the second. First pitch in a 2-2 game is low to the right-handed hitting center fielder, Dalton Mayshore. Rebels able to tie the game up with 4 base hits in the home half of the first after St. Mary scored both of their runs on one swing on a Christian Almanza home run. Mayshore, meanwhile, swings and misses at the changeup. Carbajal pulling the string on his 27th pitch of the night. Mayshore batting 288 on the year as he takes off the outside. 2-1 the count. Chong the DH next. Harrison the catcher batting third here in the second. Shade starting to cover most of the playing surface. Everybody but Rylan Charles and the left fielder Pinaro standing in the shade. That pitch up but in the zone to Mayshore as he takes a called strike 2. Mayshore, wearing number 3, the 5'10" senior out of Eagle, Idaho. The 2-2, swung on and grounded to short. To his left is Miro. He's got it. Sets the feet and fires a sidearm throw to first base. That is in time. First ground out for St. Mary's today. He had a couple of strikeouts and a runner caught stealing in the top of the first inning as Mayshore taps out 6-3. Start the second and brings up Nathan Chong.
Carby looking. Build on that consistency that we talked about at the beginning of the game for the Rebels. Now that he's settled in right now, he can start to use his pitch selection as that tumbler comes right over the plate for a called strike. And again, with what we've seen from him, it's confidence. Once he gets some momentum going, he's a really effective pitcher.
There's another slider that misses just low. Yeah. His numbers last year don't indicate how strong he finished. Mm-hmm. The 1-8 record, 6.07 ERA, nothing to write home about, but he was phenomenal down the end of the season. As this one's yanked foul by Chong, and count goes 1-1.
Yeah, it's funny you bring that up, because the last game of the season, Rebels, we knew we were eliminated from the Mountain West Conference tournament, but I talked to Carby, and I'm like, you can do this at this level, and he said, you're absolutely right.
Fastball, called for strike 3. As Nathan Chong set down via the K, third strikeout for Carbajal already. He entered the day with just 2 and 4 2/3 innings. Quickly, 2 up and 2 away as Connor Bear Harrison stands in from the right.
The Bear. Freshman.
6'3" freshman out of Danville, California. That is an experienced hitter. You can tell by the stance as he takes a pitch to the backstop.
I was just going
to
say the same thing. He stands up there like he's been doing this D1 level for quite a while. That bat looks pretty small in his hands. He's a big, strong kid. You can tell just from the stance.
That is a big boy. As he takes down and outside for a ball. Bear listed at 6'3". And no weight listed on the website. You want to take a stab at what he's pushing the scale?
I'm going to say 220.
That's exactly the number I was thinking. So he takes outside in the count. 3 balls, beg your pardon, and no strikes. Carbajal on 3-0, misses outside. Second 4-pitch walk of the evening thus far. And with 2 outs, Harrison becomes the first base runner to reach here in the inning. Brings up Jared Medham, the shortstop, batting at the bottom of the lineup.
Consistency. Previous batter, Carby's battles, throws very good breaking balls right there. Comes up against a freshman who you want to challenge at this point in his career. Can't put anything across the plate.
Wide open stance for Medham. As he takes the first pitch in on the hands for ball 1. Meanwhile, for Harrison off first, no stolen base attempts yet in the collegiate career, but this is a St. Mary's team similar to Santa Clara, both out of the WCC, that runs a lot. Yeah, 23 steals, 32 tries.
They're aggressive.
Harrison with a short lead, not the fleetest of foot as a catcher, as he watches a pitch missing low and away. Met him ahead 2-0, 6 straight balls thrown by Carbajal.
Who's the best running catcher you ever saw?
Jason Kendall, no doubt about it.
Jason Kendall, okay.
Fastball, called for a strike. Back in that category is Carbajal, though. If you count Paul Skeens, I think he's got to be up there, even though
that is one that I wouldn't have thought of.
Exclusively pitches now. And he's doing pretty darn good at it so far in his professional career with the Pittsburgh Pirates. Here's the 2-1. It's swung on and lined to right center field, fading away from Charles. That'll drop for a base hit as Ryland picks it up in the gap. The throw to the cutoff man, and with nobody at first, a huge turn around the base for Medham. He'll have to be content with the base hit. Second hit of the game, the first to stay within the yard against Carbajal. Harrison goes first to third, and That wraps the lineup back around at the top as Gavin Napier due up. He walked on four pitches to begin the game.
Good piece hitting right there. That ball got into the gap quick. Rylan Charles on his horse was able to get over there and cut that off and get it back in to hold the Big Bear at third base. But, again, Carby's one pitch away from getting out of this thing.
Napier hitting 275 thus far. A home run to go along with 11 RBIs. Good block by Seager, advancing from first to second, though, on the wild pitch is Medem. Good job to keep it in front of him, but a better read by Medem at first. So you got a 6'3" freshman that might be even taller at third. You got a 5'11" sophomore who might be even shorter at second. On 1-0, holding up on a check swing there was Napier, and he's ahead 2-0. That's been the issue for Carbajal since the first two outs is getting ahead of batters.
Yeah, and that's the one thing that we've talked about. The pitchers, the Rebels have done well this year. They've been ahead in the counts.
Line drive towards the line and right. Over to snag it at the shoot tops is Cade Higgins. So a pair of two-out base runners stranded on base. No runs on a hit, no errors, and two left on. So far, so good for Carbajal in a comeback bid. Bailey Seager to lead off in the bottom of the second. It's UNLV and St. Mary's all tied at two.
With 11 convenient full-service imaging facilities in Las Vegas, Henderson, and Corum, Desert Radiology is ready to serve. You might fall, try to do what I did. Mama's done. I'm a couple side in the middle of the club with the rubber duck. No love for the haters. Mad cause I got floor seats at the Lakers. See me on the 50-yard line with the Raiders. That I think you told me I'm the greatest.
Leading off the bottom of the second for UNLV, the catcher, number 20, Bailey Seager.
8-9-1, due up for UNLV. Here in the home half of the second. All tied at two between the Hustlin' Rebels and the Gales. Bailey Seager followed by Paul Myru. Bottom two hitters in the lineup standing in for the first time against Connor Lynchy, who threw 20 pitches and allowed a couple of runs on four hits in the first as Seager aggressively swings at the first pitch and fouls it back into the mitt of the catcher Harrison for strike one. Seager 12 of 36 to start the year. This is his 11th start in 19 games for UNLV. Watches a knee-high heater for strike two. Seager quickly behind, no balls, two strikes.
Looking at the numbers on Lynchy's fastball, 87 to 90. Curveball really slows down at 76.
It was a breaking pitch. Yeah. Over the outside, called for strike three. Seager set down on three pitches. Second strikeout for Lynchy. First out of the second. That brings up Paul Myra with nobody on. His first plate appearance of the night.
Lynchy's a four-pitch guy. Fastball, curveball, slider. Does throw a changeup occasionally.
First team all WCC last year was Lynchy. 75 in the third innings, just 55 Ks. He's got 17 strikeouts in just under 23 innings this year as he starts out behind Myro, misses outside with a breaking ball.
And just notice Paul's walk-up music. It was Earth, Wind, and Fire.
He's an old soul.
Yeah, that's an old soul right there.
My conversations with him, yeah.
It matches my old body because that Earth, Wind, and Fire was popular back when I was in junior high and high school.
Myro ahead, two balls, no strikes, with Charles on deck as the leadoff man. He swings and launches this one down the left field side, but as the lights turn on and start to take effect, that one hooks into the bullpen of the St. Mary's Gales for strike one.
That looked like a changeup that we talked about that Lynchy has. Myro just got out in front of that one, hit well, but into the bullpen.
It's ahead of this one, but fouls it straight back to the screen as the count goes even at two. Meanwhile, there is action in the St. Mary's bullpen. We expected Lynchy to not be super deep into this game because of the weird scheduling quirks. Probably going to see a couple of weekend starters throughout this brief two-game set. Miro drops a ground ball to the left side. Moving to his left is the third baseman, Pierce. Strong throw off the back foot is in time ahead of a hustling Miro for out number two. Two up and two away brings up Ryland Charles with nobody on ahead of him in the second.
Good play by Pierce right there. Breaking to his left towards short. Was able to come up with that short hop it, make a good strong throw, really from his knee slot. It's a good looking throw for a third baseman.
Charles grounded out to second to start the Rebel half of the first inning. Stands in now and takes an overhand curveball right down the chute for strike one. Warming up in the bullpen, number 29, Jason Wrights, all 6'9" of them getting loose for the Gales.
We can see him from here.
He's one of the few that you can see over that fence pretty easily. As Charles lines one to right field, that's down for extra bases. Charles rounds first as the right fielder struggles with it. Schmidt picks it up, fires it into second now. Advancing up is Ryland Charles, reaching for the first time today. On a double, his seventh of the year. Double for Charles has the go-ahead run in scoring position. Looked like he was thinking two the whole way.
Yeah, he was going two the whole way. Made a good turn off first base. Schmidt got over there to cut it off, but I think regardless of whether he was able to handle that or not, Ryland Charles was going to be in for a double.
You could tell with that big, wide turn, Charles, not the fleetest of foot,
but aggressive.
He takes great routes.
Yeah.
As Heft stands in now, J.P. Heft takes called ball one. Singled and scored in the first inning. Two to two between the Hustlin' Rebels and the Gales as the sun sets beyond the left field fence. The light's starting to take effect. Entire playing surface covered in the shade. Lynchy out of the stretch delivers. Heft hits a hot shot grounder right at the second baseman, Napier. His throw to first is in time. Advancing from second to third, but with the third out of the inning, Charles will have to watch. Heft taps out, one second baseman to another, and the Rebels unable to capitalize on a two-out double in the second. Through two, two all between St. Mary's and UNLV.
The official partner of UNLV Athletics and the official home of the Rebels on the road. 250 beers, 24/7 gaming, and seven valley locations. There's no better place to catch the Rebels.
25 sitting on 25 mil. I'm in the building and I'm feeling myself. Rest in peace, Mac Dre. I'ma do it for the bay, okay? Getting paid, we'll holler whenever that stop. My team good, we don't really need a mascot. Tell tune light one, pass it like a relay. YMCMB, come on, YMCMB.
All my life.
Ladies and gentlemen, your attention, please. Take a round for UNLV.
After two innings of work from the starter Noah Carbajal, Stan Stolte to the bullpen in the midweek non-conference series against St. Mary's, and with the score tied at two, here's the right-hander wearing number 19, Joey Acosta, SoCal native, out of the UNLV bullpen. Final line for Carbajal, whole lot of twos, two runs on two hits over two innings. He walked and struck out three over 45 pitches. He will leave with a no decision. Acosta, the 6'3" right-hander, up against Christian Almanza, who homered in the first to start the scoring. Almanza swings at the second first pitch that he's seen and pulls it foul on the first base side. He took Carbajal deep over the fence and right. After Gavin Napier took four balls to start the ballgame, Almanza then knocked his ninth shot of the year as he takes up and away here. Evens up the count at one.
Costa got the win at Stanford, pitched 6 1/3, and probably his best outing in college that he had had.
Changeup that fades away from Almanza, goes for ball two. This is the fourth appearance for Acosta. They've all been out of the pen. 1-0 with a 3.24 earned run average coming into tonight's action. And on 2-1, he misses outside with another changeup. Three balls and a strike to first baseman Almanza, who is hitting over 400 on the year.
That's been one of the Achilles' heels for Acosta this year, is missing with that changeup, and he's hit quite a few batters with it.
Almanza fouls a fastball straight back, and now with the count full, Ryan Pierce watching on deck in a 2-2 game.
When he was at New Mexico, actually plunked two batters that game with that changeup that just doesn't have a lot of movement on it against right-handed batters. He's facing the lefty here, so it's away from him. See if we can come up with a full count.
The payoff pitch fouled off the foot of Almanza as it rolls into fair territory, but out from behind the plate to signal it dead is Ryan Wilson.
When Acosta has his slider working, it's a really good pitch for him. That against a left-handed hitter like this, that ball will start out in the opposite box and work its way back across the black just on the outside of the plate.
After a foul ball on 3-2, Acosta's got a new ball and rocks and deals. Almanza fouls it off again, this time out of play, beyond the left field side. Almanza working along at bat. He is a very advanced hitter for this St. Mary's team. Big body as well at 6'4", the former Utah Ute out of Stockton, California, originally. Here we go again, the 3-2 pitch. This one put in fair territory, right between Krizek and Heft into right field for a base hit. Almanza now 2-for-2. He is 26 of 62 on the season. Just a torrid offensive pace to get it started.
Yeah, he's a good hitter right there. And against a guy like that, you can't leave anything low and in the zone. He's going to be able to pull all over that ball. Got to keep that thing just a little farther away from him being a left-handed hitter.
That's what they call too good of a strike.
That correct.
Caught a whole lot of the plate. Now Almanza too advanced to miss that one.
Now that's a great pitch right there. That slider is working in on the hands of the right-handed hitter, ends up breaking back across the plate. That's the one you got to stay in as a batter. You can bail out on that pretty easy.
Yeah, tough on a front door slider, especially in a right-on-right matchup. He goes back to the well, and Acosta gets another swing and a miss from Pierce, starting ahead, 0-2.
And this is the pitch count right here where Corey Vanderhook has been working with Joey and making sure he works ahead in the count, but he has a tendency to pitch too far inside when he's ahead in the count, and that's why he's hit so many batters over the years.
The 0-2, fisted foul on the third base side on the chopper.
There's nothing that will drive a pitching coach more crazy than being ahead 0-2 and having a hit by batter.
I used to know a coach that would make pitchers buy him a Red Bull if they gave up a hit on 0-2. If they gave up a home run on 0-2, they owed him a case. 0-2 slider off the outside, a good waste pitch, seeing if Pierce will stretch the zone.
Yeah, that's where Seager was set up, so good waste pitch right there.
Well, especially given the fact that Pierce swung and missed at strike three in the first, one of the three strikeouts over two innings from Carbajal. On 1-2, Acosta from the stretch, way up and outside. They were trying to get Pierce to oblige again, but Pierce saw that one out of the hand easily.
Fastball by Acosta there. He's looking for him to chase something up in the zone, so he's going to have to come back, work towards the zone at least, not anything too good.
Off of first is Almanza. 2-2 pitch, poked straight back. Just able to get a piece of that pitch on the hands was Pierce, the 6'4" sophomore, formerly of Fresno State, one of two former Bulldogs on the roster.
One of the things that we'll be able to track through our metrics today is the spin rate on that slider. Joey gets a high spin rate on that to get a lot of break, and it's not a lot of vertical break.
Fastball swung on and missed for strike three. How about climbing the ladder there? He gets Pierce down on strikes for the second time in as many at-bats. And that's a huge first out with Almanza on first. Not the quickest runner. Brings up Coleman Schmidt, who struck out looking in the first inning.
Yeah, great pitch sequence right there from Corey Vanderhook, who's calling those pitch sequences from the dugout into the microphones in the hats of every position player, as well as the pitcher.
Coleman Schmidt fouls the first pitch off down the right field side. Yeah, that's
One of the new technical advancements in college baseball, it's the PitchCom system that they use in both the major and minor leagues, although the big difference is that in affiliated baseball, not all nine gets them, just the guys at the middle.
Correct.
Pitcher, catcher, middle infield, and center field.
Well, it's not only sped up the game, I think it's made it a much quality game, much more quality game. That slider, that's a big bend right there. That's a great pitch. But what it's done, it's enabled the infielders to put the pick plays on. It's been enabled the catcher to communicate with the infield on what's going on. It's aligned the outfield. So it's made a much better game, in my opinion.
Here's the 0-2 slider that stays just inside. That started out at the hip of the batter.
That's what we're talking about last at bat. 0-2 coming too far inside, and he doesn't get that slider to break enough.
The PitchCom's a really cool system. If you get a chance to Google it, just see what the remote and the speakers look like. That slider's hit in the air down the first base side in foul territory. Krizic runs towards his own dugout, and the first baseman runs out of room. Count stays 1-2. The speakers themselves, I don't know if you've ever seen them.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
They look like almost like little strips of Velcro that fit
like
in the lining of the hat.
Spacers in your hats. And you can actually go on YouTube and see some of the demonstrations that have been used in games. There's some good communication going on from an alignment standpoint at pitch camp, but there's some shenanigans also.
Slider outside, even the count 2-2. Well, oblige me. What are these shenanigans?
Well, if you have a pitcher that comes in inside 0-2, there might be a choice call for that next pitch.
Wow. Okay. Yeah, I got a pretty good demonstration at the Las Vegas ballpark by the Aviators. Line drive, ripped foul, down the third base side. Keeps the count at 2-2. They're pretty customizable.
They are. And that's what it is. It's very standard. You're going to hear a voice. You can customize the voice to all kinds of different dialects to actually call the pitch, but you can add your own audio in there too.
Almost like a
you can't talk into it.
Yeah.
Right? But you can set these prompts into it.
That's the next achievement that PitchCom will hope for. 2-2 pitch. Poked straight back. Just able to stay alive there with Schmidt. Yeah, like one of those GPS systems you could program the voice. I had one growing up where we had a Snoop Dogg giving directions. I'd love to hear the
You might not get the directions before you make the turn, though. It might be a little slow.
I'd love to hear Snoop D-O double G giving me the pitches coming up next. Here's another one on 2-2 as Acosta gets a swing and a miss for strike three. Coleman Schmidt down on strikes for the second time. Back-to-back swinging strikeouts by Joey Acosta. They've both been on fastballs. He's got that thing moving. That had some tail as well away from the right-hand batter.
Yeah, and that's the thing. You get some of these pitchers who have the high velocity, but those are straight balls that are coming straight down the pipe like you talked about earlier. Got to get some tail movement on that. Get a little bit of break, a little bit of vertical. You know, his fastball right now is only 86 to 88, but to the eye, it's looking faster as it tails away.
Slider inside, and it hits Brian Duroff. Got him on the hip, a very similar pitch that he threw on 0-2 to Schmidt.
Yep, again, that's that slider that just doesn't break enough. He's got a lot of confidence to throw it. You got to back it up with the mechanics to do it.
So after a leadoff single by Almanza, back-to-back K's put two outs on the board. Almanza up to second on Duroff's second time on. He walked and was caught stealing to end the first. Hit by a pitch here in the third. It's the fourth hit batter of the year by Acosta in his third straight outing in which he's done that. Dalton Mayshore with two on and two down. Takes a called strike one at the letters. Center fielder grounds it out to shortstop to start a five-batter second inning final frame of work from Noah Carbajal, who leaves with a no decision in what's still a 2-2 game with the lights on here at the Earl. Mayshore watches outside to even up the count. It's been interesting to see, Dan, the different teams and the different uses of either the PitchCom or the other technologies that they're allowed to use.
Yeah, you know, and as this technology becomes better and newer and the new generations of these things are coming out, it's just going to add to the game. It used to be, you used to get a little beep in your hat that would tell you what the pitch is. But now with the voice recognition and all those types of things, it's just going to be better and better. And 10 years from now, we don't know what we're going to have.
On
it could be AI.
Acosta's 1-2, swung on, fouled straight down. Seager unable to squeeze it as it hit his offhand. That is painful when it keeps the count 1-2.
It's another thing we can talk about technology-wise as I don't want to start a story with two outs in the inning here, but AI is going to become a big part of baseball.
After a foul ball, another one, two from Acosta. Called for strike three over the outside. Acosta records all three outs via the K in the third for St. Mary's. No runs on a hit, no errors, and two left on base. Acosta matches a season high with three strikeouts in his lone inning of work today. And heading into the bottom of the third, UNLV tries to break a 2-2 tie.
Attention, please. Now pitching for St. Mary's is number 29, Jason Wright.
UNLV with the heart of their lineup set to lead things off in the home half of the third. With the score tied at two, Isaac Rodriguez to lead things off against a tall drink of water into the game for St. Mary's. How about the 6'9" sophomore right-hander Jason Wright out of San Jose into the game after two innings from Connor Lynchy. As Wright gives up a first pitch pop fly deep down into the right field corner. Coleman Schmidt towards the line. Schmidt just in fair territory. Tips toes the chalk, and Rodriguez set down on one pitch on the pump out to right to begin the third. Brings up Kate Higgins, who singled and scored in the first. Final line for the starter, Connor Lynchy, who leaves with a no decision after two innings. He allowed two runs on five hits. All but one of those hits, and all the runs came in the first. Lynchy didn't walk anybody and struck out two over 32 pitches, including a 12-pitch second. Wright gets ahead of Higgins with a called strike. That fastball over the outside. Wright's pitching for the fifth time this year in his sophomore campaign, 1-1 with a 7.27 ERA. 6'9" righty spins a curveball right down the middle. And Higgins behind 0-2. First pitch from Wright's 93 on the fastball. Good breaking pitch to work off of it as well. The 0-2 to Higgins, chopped up the middle. Up towards the bag is Gavin Napier. The second baseman turns and throws to first. Higgins taps out 4-3. Two up and two away against Wright, who at 6'9" would be one of the tallest pros if he were to get there in the affiliated ranks. Do you know who the number one tallest pitcher is in affiliated baseball?
Well, because I cheated and I already pulled it up on my computer. Loke Van Mill.
I remember him.
7'1". Was a Dutch pitcher, pitching the MLB for a little bit. You know, when Reitz, as he misses outside, when Reitz walked out there, I thought Randy Johnson-esque.
Right? Righty Randy.
Righty version, yeah.
Righty Randy. He's behind 1-0 against Austin Krizik. He's got some good whip on that fastball. As mentioned, it's up to 93 thus far as he steals a strike with the heater there. Krizik drove in a run on a base hit in that two-run first inning. And he fouls this breaking pitch into the seats on the right field side. Of course, there's a guy in the Giants system, Sean Jelly, who has pitched at Las Vegas Ballpark a number of times, kind of back and forth between AAA and MLB, one of those quadruple-A guys. John Roush, another one. Rare club of major leaguers to be 6'9" or above. I remember 2 years ago and 3 years ago with the Aviators, a guy named Ryan Howard, who was 6'9". He was a star, standout at TCU under Jim Schlossnagel. He's now at Texas A&M. Howard back on the coaching staff at TCU as Krizik is swinging bunt down the third base side. Touched up and foul ground by Ryan Pierce to move the count. Two balls, two strikes with two outs in the third in the 2-2 game.
Wrights is another one of the St. Mary's starting pitchers for weekend rotation. So it'll be interesting to see how many innings he goes tonight. There's nobody up in the Gales bullpen at this point. So I think they're going to look for Reitz to get through a couple. But if he's a weekend guy, you don't want to use him too much because he'll try to get back in the rotation Friday or Saturday.
Breaking pitch in the dirt. Count goes full to Krizik with Parker Schmidt on deck.
Who's the best full count hitter in the Hustlin' Rebels lineup?
Got to be Krizik, right?
Got to be. We need some stats on that one.
Fouls this pitch off and stays alive. That right there, big reason as to why he's so effective on 3-2. He's one of the better hitters at the D1 level that I've seen over the last couple of years at getting his pitch.
Correct, and he's not going to swing anything outside of the zone, but anything close, he's going to foul off.
Reitz throws high, ball four on a fastball. Second time on base tonight for Austin Krizik, once via a hit, once via a walk. And a two-out free pass brings up Parker Schmidt, who looks to separate this 2-2 game. Reitz is hard, as high as 95 on the fastball. Kind of hard to not throw hard when you've got that long of a lever, as they say, with the arm getting a ton of momentum going
yeah,
straight
down.
Yeah,
it's that whip that we're seeing from him. Very effective with that good arm slot. Good balance for a big guy.
Schmidt behind nothing and one after a swing and a miss. You can tell, too, Wright's not quite 2 years removed from Tommy John surgery his senior year of high school. A lot of times those guys, when they come back, their technique gets better because it has to.
Correct.
He doesn't have the real long looping arm action you would expect from a 6'9" right-hander. Kind of throws it from the ear like a catcher as he misses high here.
Now think about a pitcher of his height throwing sidearmed or dropping down.
Oh, God.
I mean, Kent Tekulve was tall, skinny, drink of water. He came from the side against a right-handed hitter right like this. It was brutal.
The rubber band man as Schmidt lines one through the right side of the infield. A base hit on 1-1. Advancing up to second base is Krizik. Two-out base runners, and the Rebels threatening in the third. Duan for Santino Pinaro, who flied out to shallow to left field to wrap up the two-run first.
Good opportunity here for the left-handed hitting Pinaro to drive something in for the Rebels, something in the gap for a big man, as well as Krizik's put together. He can motor.
Krizik's off second, Schmidt off first. As the catcher Harrison sets up outside, first pitch way off the plate as Pinaro moves ahead 1-0.
I think that's the first changeup we've seen from Reitz so far.
Pinaro 0-for-1 today, averaged just over 280 on the year. He was a combined 1-for-7 against Santa Clara. Lines this one to the gap in right center. That'll score Krizik from second. Rounding second and heading to third is Schmidt. He'll be in there safely. An RBI base hit from Santino Pinaro in the third. And the Rebels with their first lead of the night. It's a 3-2 game.
Great job by Santino Pinaro going down low and hitting that fastball into the gap. Runners were advancing right there, so that was a hit and run called by the hitting coach, third base coach Kevin Higgins. But those were, Krizik was easily around to score, and that allowed runners now at the corners for the Rebels with two outs, but something working.
And a chance for Bailey Seager to crack this one open. Seager struck out looking against the starter Lynchy in the second. Good size lead off of first for Pinaro. He doesn't go anywhere as Seager trying to hold up on a check swing, but called for a strike by Ryan Wilson. They call that the sword nowadays. You trying to hold it up like that and are unable to. 3-2 UNLV on top here in the home half of the third inning. Seager steers down Wrights and pops one up foul. Out of play on the right field side. Count quickly, nothing and two against the eight hitter.
Not to be overlooked, but we talked about it in his first at bat, Parker Schmidt, now quiet, 2-for-2. He's just a guy that's gotten the lineup, and I love the way he's taken advantage of his opportunities.
16-of-46, back and forth between the lineup and the bench. Runner breaks from first. The pitch a called strike. Seager down via the K, but into second safely is Santino Pinaro. His first steal. His first attempt. That's the third out. Everybody in the field froze. It deked me out.
Yeah, that was a called strike, but that ball looked like it was low and away outside the zone.
So instead, no stolen base for Pinaro, and that will not go as an attempt as Seager down via the backwards K for the second time. But the Rebels on the board and in the lead. An RBI base hit by Pinaro has them on top 3-2 after three innings full from Earl E. Wilson Stadium.
More than Santino Pinaro, you'll be going home with a Canes prize pack. Tonight's category is Things with Wheels. Are you ready? 15 seconds on the clock and go.
Car, truck, garbage truck, school bus, scooter, motorcycle, bicycle, ATV, train, skateboard.
Three, two, one. All right, check out the board. Let's see how Santino did.
Cars, wagons, bikes, scooters, skateboards, shopping carts.
It's not even close. Final score, 12-6. We have a winner. Congratulations. You have won the Raising Cane's High Speed Rebel Challenge. Enjoy the game, and thank you for supporting Raising Cane's. At the plate, DH number 20, Nathan Chong.
Bottom third of the lineup to get it going for St. Mary's. UNLV leads it 3-2 here in the top of the third inning as Nathan Chong swings and misses. At a first pitch fastball from Joey Acosta. Acosta, the first man out of the pen, pitching in his second inning of work. Struck out the side while giving up a hit and a walk in the third. Watched as the Rebels battled back and took a lead in the bottom of the inning as he gets a strike called against Chong to move it ahead, 0-2. Acosta now the pitcher of record for the Rebels. Santino Pinaro with an RBI base hit to break a 2-2 tie. As Chong pops one up, out of play. That one beyond the clubhouse down the right field side. And Acosta ahead, 0-2. That hasn't been a challenge today, getting the 0-2 count for Joey. It's been what happens next.
Correct. Now, history tells me he's going to come inside with a slider here.
It hit Duroff in a similar spot, the similar pitch. He goes outside with the slider, and that's more of what you would like to see on 0-2.
Yeah, that's the pitch that I think Corey Vanderhook is probably talking to him about in the dugout.
Infield deep, outfield straight up against the DH Chong, who struck out in his other at-bat. He swings and misses here, down on strikes for the second time tonight. Fourth strikeout through six batters for Joey Acosta. That's a new season high for him, and he's through just an inning and a third in his fourth appearance of the year.
Yeah, that's the kind of performance that coming into the season, the fall season, Joey was really showing to the pitching coaches. So although he had a good outing against Stanford, the last two were subpar. Time to get back to the Stanford level.
Acosta misses high. First pitch for ball one to Bear Harrison, who took a four-pitch walk from Carbajal in the second. So Harrison has seen five pitches, none of them in the zone. That one swung on and missed. Would have been a strike anyway. Acosta comes back to even the count.
And when Joey went into Stanford in Palo Alto, pitched 7 1/3 innings, that was against the number 23 team in the country at the time. So he was facing good batters.
Another swing and a miss by Harrison. And Acosta ahead 1-2 now.
Seems to be in a better flow at this point.
Honestly, he works better when he works faster.
Yeah.
We saw it from Carbajal, a noted increase in his tempo from before. As Acosta rocks and deals out of the full wine. The 1-2 pitch just inside, called for ball two against Harrison.
It's a good pitch, though, right there.
Especially against a freshman. You know, challenge him in on the hands.
Mm-hmm.
Although it was away from Seager, so he just kind of flipped the glove over there. And how many umps are going to call that one?
Guarantee you're going to see a slider.
2-2. It's a slider. It's a pitch swung on and missed in the dirt for strike three. Seager out in front of the plate. Going down to Krizik at first in time. A strikeout. 2-3 on the putout. Back-to-back Ks for Acosta in the third. He's got five in an inning and two-thirds. It's an incredible outing when it comes to strikeouts so far for Acosta. He'll look to strike out the side for the second straight inning as Jared Medham stands in now.
You go back to the Rebel game over the weekend against Santa Clara. We had 15 strikeouts in a game. Austin Cates, 10. And
it was Gonzalez.
It was Gonzalez. Isaac Gonzalez had another five. Also, the opposing pitchers had 10 against us, 25 for a game, which you don't see a lot in college baseball.
Out of 54 outs in total. There we go. Quick math. Nothing and one. Acosta deals to Medem, who swings and fouls another one back. This one off the mid of the catcher, Seager, and Acosta into another 0-2 count, this time against Medem, who singled in the second.
Pitching with some confidence right now. Love to see this from this young man. He's got the tools. We talked about the tools and the ability that Carbajal has. Costa's just right there with him.
Would love to see him go right after the number nine hitter here with the on-deck man, Napier, on deck. 0-2 offering. Another foul ball. This one will leave the yard on the first baseline.
He challenged him right there with the fastball, so you're exactly right. But that fastball right there being late on it sets him up for a lot of different opportunities from a pitching standpoint right here.
Because he knows he's late. He knows the hitter's late on it, so we may see another fastball here. He's had luck with it elevated also. We'll see. Another 0-2. Breaking pitch. Swung on and missed for strike three. Acosta strikes out the side in order this time as he has six strikeouts in two innings full of work. And with the bats backing him up, the Rebels, after 3.5, lead St. Mary's 3-2.
UNLV fans, the Hustler Rebels will be back at home tomorrow. That's March 20th for game two of this quick two-game set against the St. Mary's Gales. First pitch is set for 2:05 p.m., so be sure to get here early. That's tomorrow, March 20th, 2:05 p.m., right here at Early Wilson Stadium. Leading off the bottom of the fourth for UNLV, the shortstop, number three, Paul Miro, the fourth.
With UNLV on top, 3-2, we begin the bottom of the fourth inning with the bottom of the lineup as Paul Miro, the fourth, works his way around from the first base home side dugout to the right-handed batter's box. Miro chopped out to third for the second out of a four-batter second against the starter, Lynchy. This is first time up against the 6'9" righty, Jason Wrights. He gets him to chop one to third again. This time picked up by Pierce deep in the hole, and a strong throw across the diamond is in time. Miro with identical 5-3 groundouts in the scorebook in his first two at-bats. And his lineup wraps back around at the top against Rylan Charles. This is the type of hitter that I think Rylan would love to have as many at-bats against as he can. He loves the hard fastballs. He likes elevated pitches in the zone. Wrights, plenty of both of those. Squares to bunt, pulls it back on an elevated fastball. It does miss for ball one.
So the other thing, too, is he pulled that ball down the right field line, but he also had those high elevated fastballs. He can spray those all over the yard.
There's a fastball. Watching all the way is Rylan Charles, and it's called strike by Ryan Wilson behind the dish. Charles with the aforementioned double in the second, coming after he grounded out to second to start the UNLV offense in the first. Wrights with the 1-1 delivery. Pitch swung on and missed. Looked like a changeup that Charles was early on. And he's behind 1-2.
Yeah, when you have that 95-mile-an-hour working, if you can develop even a semi-decent change, that's a tough out.
6'9" righty, Jason Wrights misses low. Two balls and two strikes the count. I mean, this is a unique frame, unique pitch set as well. A 95 from an elevated vantage point like that looks a heck of a lot faster. Charles checks the swing on a pitch in the dirt, able to hold up, and the count goes full on a bouncing ball three.
Wright's only a sophomore. He's going to continue to develop.
He made just three starts out of 12 outings overall last year in his freshman campaign, first year back from Tommy John. As Charles hits a hot shot grounder to the left of the second baseman, Napier, but he gobbles it up and throws to first base in time. Back-to-back groundouts and rights ahead with two outs and nobody on for J.P. Heft, who's one of two. Rebels lead this one 3-2, first of a two-game set. 2:05 scheduled first pitch here on the West Coast tomorrow. As the Rebels look to Reno for the weekend. They'll take on the Wolfpack in the Silver State Showdown. But first, a non-con set against the Gales of St. Mary's. As Wrights bounces a fastball to Heft for ball one.
We come home Sunday off the road trip and move right into a Monday against Arizona State at the ballpark. Monday night.
Heft with a line drive base hit right back where it came up the middle. Coming in to grab it as the center fielder made sure. Heft now 2-for-3. And he continues to rake. That's his 29th hit of the year. Only Kate Higgins is within three hits of him. He's the only one even close. J.P. Heft out of Saddleback College. Talked to Kevin Higgins preseason. He said, this was the guy that we recruited to be our starting second baseman. We can see why now after 19 games, including tonight.
Yeah, and I knew they knew he had some offense, but what he's shown has been outstanding for the Rebels.
First pitch swinging is Isaac Rodriguez, another guy that they recruited with a lot of playing time in mind. He misses at strike one. I-Rod, as they call him, 0-for-2. He struck out, and he's popped out to right. He was the first batter that Rice faced when he came into the game to start the third inning. Snaps a throw to first base. It's off the glove of the first baseman, Almanza. He deflected it, slowed it down just enough to where it didn't trickle too far away. Unable to advance off first is Heft.
You know, I was just going to say something. As Heft had a pretty decent lead right there, what kind of move does Reitz have going to first base? I mean, he fired that over. That's a 90-mile-an-hour fastball to first base.
Misses outside. Yeah, it's one thing for a catcher who's used to seeing 95 coming at him, but if you're first baseman, you can be taken aback. It's a shorter distance as well.
At much shorter distance, and if the ball's up at your eyes, makes it that much harder.
Almanza's not short either. He's 6'4". Wright's tower is nearly 6 inches above him. Unfamiliar spot, I'm sure, for guys like Almanza as Rodriguez takes low and the count goes 3-1. Jason Wrights. It is a unique sight on the hill. He's got the pants pulled up about halfway up the shin. I don't know if they make pants long enough to go all the way down. Bouncing ball with the runner breaking, but it's ball four anyway. Ball four moves Heft up to second, so no stolen base attempt for him. And Rodriguez on for the first time tonight. Via the base on balls, he walked three times and was hit by a pitch in the series finale against Santa Clara in the most recent action for UNLV. Two on with one out, and they're going to pull Isaac Rodriguez back? It was 3-1, correct? It was a 3-1 count.
That was a 3-1 count.
Head coach Eric Valenzuela coming out to argue, and must have been successful. Rodriguez was standing on first. They had to bring him back a new bat. So they're trying to figure out exactly what the count was. Looks like it's going to be 3-1, so that will be a stolen base for Heft. That will be a stolen base for Heft on second, his second and three tries on the year. And Rodriguez allegedly still had 3-1.
Very interesting, though, because he heard ball four, didn't make a throw down to second base, so easily stole the base.
And this one's lined into center field. He'd much rather have the base hit. Rounding third and coming around to score is J.P. Heft. And I'm sure Isaac Rodriguez,
yeah,
this is the better result than a walk. Instead, it's an RBI single, his eighth ribby of the year. Heft scoring easily after his second steal. And it is now a 4-2 game. UNLV doubling up St. Mary's.
You know, I think Eric Valenzuela had a very valid point, because if you're going to call ball four, catcher's going to stop and not throw down to second base. But because they said there was only two balls in the count, that allowed him to advance and now off the single, come home.
Kate Higgins swings and misses at a first pitch breaking ball. Yeah, I'd like them to lose track of the count a little bit more often. Higgins, who's one of two with an RBI, or rather a run scored after a base hit, takes a bouncing ball off the chest of the catcher. Moving up to second is Rodriguez on a wild pitch. Second wild pitch of the game. First for Wrights. That puts another runner in scoring position. Sets up Higgy with an RBI chance with two outs. Downhill. We think the count's 1-1. No, it definitely is 1-1. It was a swing and a miss and a pitch in the dirt. Shortstop met him in the back pocket of Rodriguez leading off second. Higgins, it's a cap shot ground ball straight back. And now the count, 1-2. Higgins with 27 hits on the year, hitting over 370, but just the 9 runs batted in, though. We talked about it, 7 doubles, a home run, and a triple. That's 10 extra base hits for him.
Be a good time for just a single.
Single scores the runner from second easily. On 1-2, he grounds it off the pitcher. Right in front of the mound to pick it up. Slings one sidearm to first, and it's in time. A painful 1-3 comebacker up the middle. Ends the inning, but an RBI base hit after what he thought was ball four. Gives Isaac Rodriguez an RBI and extends the lead. UNLV on top of St. Mary's after 4 full. It's 4-2.
Rebel fans, download the UNLV Game Day app today and stay up to date on all of your favorite UNLV teams with notifications straight to your phone. Get tonight's game program, schedules, live stats, rosters, streaming audio and video, venue maps, and special offers from UNLV partners. Search UNLV Rebels in the Apple and Google Play stores and download the app today. Fans, join your Hustlin' Rebels on Thursday, March 28th for some bowling and fun at the Orleans Bowling Center, presented by Findlay Toyota. Sign up with a group of 4 or a pair and come win some prizes. Food and drink will be available. You can sign up under the additional link section of the UNLV baseball page. So head over to the UNLVRebels.com to learn more. That's UNLVRebels.com. Leading out the top of the fifth for St. Mary's, the second baseman, number 2, Gavin Napier.
Joey Acosta back out for the fifth. Top of the St. Mary's lineup to lead things off. UNLV on top of the Gales, 4-2. Swinging and missing at a first pitch fastball is Gavin Napier, who's lined out to right. Walked and scored to lead off the game. Rebels able to expand the lead to a pair on an Isaac Rodriguez RBI base hit in the fourth as Acosta ahead, nothing and two. Just a weird sequence in the bottom of the fourth inning. Heft breaking from third on what was a 3-1 count. Pitch in the dirt should have been called ball four and was initially. Slider outside for ball one. Eric Valenzuela, the head coach of St. Mary's, went out to argue. He got home plate umpire Ryan Wilson to call Isaac Rodriguez back. He probably wishes that he had, because then the very next pitch was lined into center for an RBI single. As this one's popped up high in the air, shallow to right. Coming in is Higgins. Going back is the first baseman, Krizik. It'll be Higgy in fair territory to make the catch for out number one. It's the first out in 2 1/3 innings that Joey Acosta has not recorded via a strikeout. He'll take it all the same, but he has been phenomenal at missing bats tonight. He'll try to do the same against a guy who is 2-for-2 with a home run and a base hit in Christian Almanza, the top hitter by far for the St. Mary's team.
And this is a guy you just want to be careful with. Can't put anything right down the pipe for Almanza because he's gonna take that one for a ride as he fouls that one off. Looked like a little bit of a changeup right there to start him off with. So if you can keep Almanza off balance, I think that's going to be key. Working ahead in the count, and when you can, work outside the zone.
First team all WCC last year. Almanza takes just off the outside to even it up. He was the West Coast Conference Player of the Year, along with Austin Deming of BYU. 53 hits and 183 at-bats. Swings and fouls one back into the mitt, falling behind 1-2. 16 home runs a year ago for Almanza, second most in school history. He blasted his 9th of the year already in the first inning. He played just 17 games, including tonight. Almanza, amazing offensive pace. As he takes a slider that stays outside. Acosta trying to bring it in through the back door, but no dice.
That's
the count
a
evens
good
up
pitch,
two.
Though. Regardless, that's a great pitch right there.
Acosta working quickly. He deals. That slider stays way outside, and the count goes full with the three-hitter Ryan Pierce on deck.
Again, you just want to be careful here with one out, empty bases against probably one of the best hitters on the West Coast.
Certainly. Let's see what Acosta's got dialed up. Right-hander deals. Almanza swings and misses at strike three, offering up at a pitch on the shoot tops. Strikeout number seven for Joey Acosta through 2 2/3. Quickly two up and two away here in the fifth, and that's six straight batters set down.
Seventh strikeout for Joey Acosta.
Crazy. Seven Ks. He's allowed a base hit, and he's hit a batter. That's been it. I mean, only at bat that was a strikeout, or not a strikeout otherwise, was the fly out to right. As the first pitch in for a strike to Pierce, who has struck out twice, although just once against Acosta. Acosta throws a slider, another swing and a miss, and another 0-2 count. He has been masterful at getting ahead nothing and two in this outing.
That changeup he's thrown, the spin rate's sub 900, which means that ball's got a lot of movement on it.
Almost like a fork ball coming in there. Just able to reach out and get a piece with the end of the bat as Pierce here to stay alive. You see, back in the day, they used to call it a palm ball.
Mm-hmm.
Just kind of grab it with all your fingers and let it go. But Acosta doing a great job. There's a guy, Cesar Valdez, in the Angels system who has a changeup like that. He calls it his dead fish changeup. He said it looks like a dead fish coming out of the hand.
Well, when I was pitching back in high school, my hand wasn't very big. I had to throw that pitch. That was one of my go-tos.
I was taught really young. You grab your fastball grip, you just slap a third finger on there, and there's your changeup. I'm sure Acosta's got more detail to it than that. On 1-2, there's a breaking ball hit to the right side in shallow right field. It's J.P. Heft up with it and throwing to first. Pierce now 0-3. Joey Acosta works through his second straight 1-2-3 inning. He has struck out seven. And three innings full, seven of the nine outs he's recorded have been via the K. Acosta with one of, if not his best outings of the year. And through half a ball game, 4.5 innings down and 4.5 to go, UNLV leads St. Mary's 42.
Me the first time we dated, but she was no angel and we never waited. I took her for sushi, she wanted it, so we took it to go. Told them don't even plate it, and we never talked too much after I blew up. Just only hello her, happy belated, and I think I texted and told her I made it. And that's when she texted me and told me she prayed it. And that's when I texted and told her I love it. And right after texting and told her I'm faded, she asked, what have I learned since getting rich? I've been working with the negatives to make.
Ladies and gentlemen, your attention please. Taking the mound for the Gales is number 43, Ryan Wiltsey.
For me to revisit the past, as women that call us, I'm the drop, the flipping involved, the stories to tell, we've been through it all. Interviews are like confessions, get the about my dressing room, confusing me with questions like, do you love this shit? Are you high right now? Do you ever get nervous? Are you single? I heard you, hey girl, is it true? You getting money? You think the two witness with you? Can I say, hell yeah, hell yeah.
Leading off the bottom of the fifth for the Rebels, the first baseman, number 47, Austin.
A new arm atop the mound for the visiting St. Mary's Gales. Bottom of the fifth, UNLV leads the visitors 4-2. 6'3" senior right-hander Ryan Wiltsey toes the slab. Wiltsey spelled W-I-L-T-S-E, up against Austin Krizik to begin the fifth. Joey Acosta, through three masterful innings, has allowed just one hit. And as Krizik falls behind, nothing and one on a fastball. Wiltsey, the third pitcher of the game, used by Eric Valenzuela. Jason Wright, just like Connor Lynchy ahead of him, threw exactly two innings. Krizik swings and misses behind a fastball and falls behind nothing and two. The final line for Jason Wright, who is the pitcher of record as of now for St. Mary's. Two runs, four hits, one walk, one strikeout over 38 pitches. And two innings full. Wiltsey gets a pitch popped up right at the right fielder Schmidt. I think he took three steps to the right in total before gloving it for the out. First time that Krizik has been retired. He had singled and walked prior. One out, nobody on in a 4-2 game. Here's another guy who has not been retired. He's had a great start to his career in the Scarlet and Gray, and Parker Schmidt.
Wiltsey's been very effective in his seven appearances this year. Picked up two wins, everything coming out of the bullpen.
First pitch swinging. Parker Schmidt rips one fair inside the base at third for extra bases. He takes the turn and heads to second base as Duroff picks it up from the base of the wall. Sliding in ahead of a strong throw is Parker Schmidt. He's now 3-for-3. That's his second double and third extra base hit of the year.
Yeah, we noted last at bat, just that quiet 2-for-2, and all of a sudden you look up and 3-for-3. He's that guy, just like J.P. Heff, that has taken advantage of every opportunity that he's had here in the lineup, and he's just consistently delivered night in and night out. It's hard to keep a guy like that out of the lineup. You're going to find a home for him.
Hit the ball hard, and you will find a spot in the lineup. That went 103 miles an hour on the exit velocity. He stroked it. Brings up Santino Pinar, who's 1-of-2. Squares to bunt, pulls it back on a pitch that goes off the glove of the catcher, Harrison, advancing Schmidt to third on a pass ball.
They're going to say he left that bat out. Well, they're marking it. Looked like the umpire made a signal for a strike. That was a strike.
A pitch in the zone, but Pinar had pulled it back. That's a pass ball by very definition. And with the game at 4-2 and one out, the infield now drawn in against Santino. Look to drive something over their heads with Schmidt on third. Wiltsy gives up a ground ball off the glove of the diving first baseman Almanza into shallow right field. That'll score Schmidt easily on the second RBI single in as many at bats for Santino Pinaro, extending the lead. It's now a 5-2 advantage for the Hustlin' Rebels.
Just going to say before that pitch, that with the infield pulled in like that, that's tailor-made. That's tailor-made right there for the left fielder, Pinaro. He's always been a pretty good contact hitter. He doesn't have to hit it real hard, but found a gap right there. Extends the Rebel lead to 3 now.
Bailey Seeger with the runner on first and one down. Pinaro breaks from first. This pitch swung on and blasted. Deep to left center field. Mayshore turns around at the track, moves back in towards the field of play, and makes the catch on the move. So Pinaro back to first. A well-hit ball by Seeger, and it was early in the at-bat. Comes after he had struck out looking twice. He was ready to swing and nearly got all of that one.
Yeah, staying very aggressive right there. Pinaro broke to second base. Not sure if that was a straight hit and run or that was a steal, and Miro liked the pitch. Regardless, long out for Paul Miro for the second of the inning. That sends Pinaro back to first base.
Here's Paul Miro at the bottom of the lineup, taking a strike over the outside. Pinaro off first after his second RBI of the day and his ninth of the year, matching Cade Higgins in that category.
I'm sorry, earlier that was Seeger with Miro coming up now. Well hit ball.
Miro nothing for two. He's grounded out to third twice. Wiltsy out of the stretch. Miro swings late on an elevated heater and falls behind. That double, by the way, for Parker Schmidt, the first extra base hit that Wiltsy had allowed out of what is now 9 hits on the year. Opponents had been batting just 132 against him coming into this outing in total.
Yeah, he's been effective for the Gales.
He's ahead, nothing and two. Misses way off the outside. The catcher Harrison up out of the squad early. That was a called pitch with a look to Pinaro at first afterwards.
Correct. You don't see the catcher step that far towards the pitcher, though, on a pitch out. Just in case the velocity takes it by him.
They're keeping an eye on Pinaro at first as he dives back in head first and safely ahead of a throw. This is a guy in Santino that had not attempted a stolen base hit on the air. He has attempted them twice today, but both times the batter at the plate had put the ball in play, negating the attempt. Mayo trying to find a way on for the first time. The 1-2 chopped foul down the third base side. Pinaro way ahead of that curveball from Wiltsy. Wiltsy pitching for the Gales for his third year. 4-2 with the 5.04 ERA in the freshman campaign. Last year, 3-6 with a 6.84 earned run average. 22 outings, including 8 starts. This is his 8th outing of the year this year with 0 starts. True bullpen piece for the Gales this season is Pinaro, or rather Paul Miro, the fourth of the plate, takes high.
Attempted frame by Bear Harrison right there. He almost got that call.
Wiltsy has seen his strikeout numbers increase since moving to the pen. He's fanned 21 batters in just over 15 innings coming into this one. Miro able to get a piece and stay alive as the count stays even at 2. If Paul can find a way on, Ryland Charles awaits on deck. Big gap on the right side of the infield as well, with the second baseman Napier practically behind the base at second. Outfield deep with two down, no wind whatsoever. Here his day is faded into night on a Tuesday evening at Early Wilson Stadium. Miro down to a knee as he swings and misses at strike three. 22nd strikeout on the year for Wiltsy is his first of the night. But the Rebels add on after a one-out double by Parker Schmidt, scoring on a Santino Pinaro RBI single, his second in as many at-bats. The Rebels, through five innings full, lead the Gales by a 5-2 score.
To take on Arizona State over at the Las Vegas ballpark on Monday, March 25th, first pitch at 6:05 p.m. Be sure to head over to aviatorslv.com or thelvballpark.com to get your tickets today. Again, that's Monday, March 25th, 6:05 p.m. at Las Vegas ballpark. Leading off the top of the sixth for St. Mary's, number 27, Coleman Schmidt.
Middle third of the St. Mary's lineup, and to lead things off against Joey Acosta in the sixth. Rebels right-handed reliever misses outside to Coleman Schmidt, who has struck out twice, once against Acosta. And Acosta has become accustomed to the strikeout. Seven Ks through three innings as he begins his fourth 1-1, steals a strike against Schmidt here. Rebels entering the game, 10-8 on the year. St. Mary's 10-6. They'll make their first WCC conference series this weekend. Line drive, slap to right, towards the line is Higgins. He leaps up and the right fielder can't get it. It's over his head and bouncing off the base of the fence into second. On a stand-up leadoff double is Coleman Schmidt. Becomes the third leadoff man to reach for the Gales through six innings, beg your pardon. And in a 5-2 game with UNLV on top, here's Brian Duroff, a right-handed hitter. With one on, nobody out.
Brian Duroff.
Rebels with the three-game weekend set, as we had mentioned, coming up in Reno against the Wolfpack. 6:05, 2:05, and 12:05. The three first pitch times on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday of this weekend. And then a fun one coming up on Monday. What's become a yearly tradition for UNLV, playing over at the Las Vegas ballpark on the west side of town in Summerlin, home of the Las Vegas Aviators. Acosta misses off the outside to Duroff, who has walked and been hit by a pitch. 6:05 first pitch against Arizona State. Always good to get a premier blue blood opponent in a special game like that.
Yeah, this will be our third year we've been able to have a game over there. That ball just misses, take the count 2-0. But Don Logan and the Aviators and the AAA affiliate of the Oakland A's done a really good job of hosting us over there, making the kids feel really special, getting able to play in the best AAA ballpark in the country.
Yeah, bar none. Might be a little biased, but.
Well, unless you work there.
I it is other people's opinions. It's just one that I happen to agree with.
Yeah, it gives the kids a different, and I say kids, these are young men, but they're still kids. They get jacked up about going to a place like that. They go watch those games throughout the year, so it gives them a chance to play on that field.
It is the biggest video board in the minor leagues. There's no debate about that. As Acosta picks the leg, looks to second, but no throw. Back to the bases, Schmidt. Did you know that the video board over there is bigger than, I think the number is still 6 big league video boards?
I did not know that.
It is one of the biggest ones in all the professional baseball, top 30 to be sure. Fastball at the letters, a strike, as Duroff was ready to head down to first. He's got to stand back in for at least one more as the count goes 3-1. Get your tickets at aviatorslv.com or thelvballpark.com as UNLV takes on Arizona State this Monday, March 25th at 6:05.
And if you can't join us, you will be on the call.
Yep, that'll be a good one. On the Mountain West Network as well. There's a foul ball, fouled back off the mitt. And Duroff moves full at 3-2. The best by far 2 years ago when Darian Williams nearly hit a game-winning walk-off grand slam
yep.
in the bottom of the 10th It ended up being a triple.
It did.
And he ended up being the game's winning run one batter later, but the granny would have been nice. I know he would have told you that. A throw back to second base, and I don't know if Myro fielded that cleanly, but it was off the gut of Coleman Schmidt.
Yeah, luckily that did hit the rib cage of Schmidt. Ball would have gone all the way into center field, and he probably would have been able to advance to third. But that night over at the Aviator Ballpark is absolutely fantastic. And every year we're hosting Arizona State, and then we'll reciprocate and go down there for one.
Line drive knocked straight back on 3-2. Count stays full.
And we would have to go back. Maybe we can get Jake to look at some numbers for us. But we've had a lot of success over the last 20 years against the Aztecs down there. And I know that that one's pretty personal for Coach Kevin Higgins.
And his son, Kate, who played there for a couple of years as well. Yeah. Of course, Higgy in the Arizona State Hall of Fame, one of the best players in the history of that program. This one's off the outside as Acosta, after a long at-bat, walks Duroff. He has now hit him and walked him. Duroff has reached three times without a base hit. Two walks, and he was hit once. Two on, nobody out in the sixth. And here comes Stan Stolte out to have a word with first Ryan Wilson and then Joey Acosta.
Joey Acosta actually signaled to the dugout, this is an injury check. This is not a mound visit.
And he's grabbing on the upper part of the back of his arm near the tricep.
Trainer's rolling out.
Kind of that lat area as well. Yeah, you hate to see that, especially for a guy that had been throwing so successfully tonight. So Oscar Lopez Huerta heads out. Athletic trainer for UNLV to take a look at Joey Acosta. And, yeah, that's the exact spot that he's touching up. Acosta looks uncomfortable as ever up there on the hill. And Stan Stolte immediately turns to the bullpen and looks like he won't take any chances. He wants to make a move. The question is who?
Well, for an injury change right here, whoever comes in is going to get as much time to warm up as they possibly need.
And it's a left-hander, Will Girardi, wearing number 31. Girardi coming out. And as you had mentioned, Dan, he'll have as much time to warm up. We will allow him that much time as we step aside. Acosta pulled from the game with what looks like an arm injury. We wish Acosta all the best and update you if or when we hear anything. Will Girardi will have as much time as he needs to warm up. He'll come into a fortuitous game with the Rebels on top 5-2. Schmidt on second, Duroff on first. First batter he'll face will be Dalton Mayshore when we come back. junior left-hander Will Girardi on the hill as Joey Acosta lifted from the game after three innings plus with what looks to be an arm injury. We'll wish Joey all the best. And again, keep you updated if or when we hear anything. Girardi enters into the game with two on and two down. Runners on first and second for Dalton Mayshore, the right-handed batting center fielder. Mayshore squares to bunt, pulls it back on a first pitch breaking ball that misses low from Girardi, who's pitching for the sixth time this year and looking to bring down a 14.04 ERA. Girardi, originally from the Chicago area, pitching for the first time this year here in the Scarlet and Gray. 8 1/3 innings, he's given up 13 earned runs out of 17 total on 11 hits and 10 walks. He'll look to find the zone against Mayshore here. He does, and a fastball right down Broadway in the count, even at one. Mayshore grounded out to short to start the second. He struck out looking to end the third against Acosta, who leaves the game after striking out seven. He recorded nine outs and was missing a ton of bats. It was a shame to see him lifted from the game when he was because of the injuries. Mayshore goes the other way, puts a charge into this one deep to right center field. Off the base of the wall, this is gonna score one. Schmidt had held up, but he comes around to score. Tagging from third, and staying there is Duroff. Duroff, two-base advancement on a two-base hit from Mayshore. An RBI double with a run charge to Acosta. Makes it a 5-3 game. Schmidt able to score from second as Duroff advanced up to third. Mayshore now with 12 RBIs on the year, and it brings up Nathan Chong from the right side. Beg your pardon. Designated hitter, using a designated, or a pinch hitter, beg your pardon, from Valenzuela. It'll be the right-hander, Chris Esquivel. Esquivel in from the right side as the 5'10" sophomore from San Diego. Bats with two on and nobody out. Corner infielder's drawn in as Girardi steals a strike over the inside. Esquivel pinch hitting for Chong, who was 0-2 with a couple of Ks. So to the bench goes Eric Valenzuela. And Esquivel in 8 at bat stand has had good luck. 4 hits. It's a 500 batting average. This one by Seager on a wild pitch. And scoring from third is Duroff. Both of those runs charged to Acosta. Makes it a one-run game at 5-4. And Joey's line is done. Advancing from second to third on that wild pitch was Mayshore.
Yeah, those are the types of pitches right there that you can't gift the Gales at this point in the game, as they've clawed their way back in, only trailing by one. Runner on third with no outs. It's a situation where you just got to play catch.
And now Bailey Seager goes out rather slowly to have a word with Will Girardi. And you think this is to just try to slow the left-hander down?
Yeah, I mean, Girardi, you know, he's had two different times where he's struggled a little bit. At Stanford, gave up four earned. At New Mexico, gave up four earned. But, you know, he's had three outings where there's been no earned runs, and it looks like might have a pitching change already.
It typically, Stan Stolte doesn't emerge from the dugout unless it's a pitching change, and he will. He waited at the foul line before crossing it, pointed to the bullpen, and you want to talk about a quick hook. He's going to take Will Girardi out in the middle of an at-bat. He gives up a double, throws a wild pitch, two-run score, both charged to Acosta, and that's it for Girardi. As short an outing as we've seen from anybody on the Rebels this season, and Albert Robles, wearing number 41, comes jogging out of the bullpen. Robles in behind Girardi, fourth pitcher used by Stolte, and we'll let him get warmed up in what is now a 5-4 ball game. It'll be the middle of the at-bat with Esquivel, even at one, coming up next.
Ladies and gentlemen, your attention, please. Taking the mound for the Rebels, number 41, Albert Robles. Bye.
At the plate, number 12, Chris Esquivel.
Chris Esquivel still batting. You'll see the second pitcher of the at-bat as Will Girardi was lifted after just a handful of pitches. Albert Robles, big right-hander wearing number 41, in out of the right field bullpen. And Esquivel stares him down on 1-1. Robles out of the stretch, throws a 12-6 curveball into the dirt. Call for ball one. Runner on third is the responsibility of Girardi. He came in and surrendered a pair of inherited runners. Acosta final with two earned runs on two hits over three innings. He walked one and struck out a season-best 7. Robles fires a fastball on the black of the outside, and the count goes even at 2. Esquivel pinch hitting for Chong. Ethan Chong was 0 for 2 with a couple of Ks. Robles hoping for another one right here. He sets, takes a deep breath, and delivers. Swing and a miss, strike 3. Touching him up is the catcher, Seager, for the putout. Esquivel down on strikes. That DH spot now with 3 strikeouts on the day, and that's out number 1 in the 6th. So Mary's has played it 2 runs on 2 hits, a walk, and a wild pitch thus far here in the 6th. And with Mayshore on 3rd, here's Bear Harrison, the catcher, who is 0 for 1 with a walk and a strikeout.
That's a tough spot for Robles to come in. No, he's 1-1 in the count, but the strikeout, huge right there. Stranding the runner at 3rd with 1 out now. Again, another strikeout right here would be key for Robles to get out of this inning with no more damage done.
First pitch to Harrison high. Here comes the 1-0 from the stretch. Harrison watches a pitch just below the knees for ball 2. Robles has been a strikeout machine this year. That was his 13th strikeout in 11 2/3 innings. He got the final 2 outs, although none via the K on Sunday in the 9-5 loss against St. Mary's. Finished up the 9th behind Girardi. A hot shot ground ball at right to second base. Not fielded cleanly by J.P. Half, but he's able to recover in time. And the throw to first that nearly pulls Krizik off the bag is in time. Meanwhile, scoring from 3rd on an RBI ground out is Mayshore. We're back where we started, all tied at 5, although with the middle infield shaded deep, they were prepared to trade the out for the tying run there.
Yeah, absolutely. Harrison knew that and came up there with a plan, and that's one of the things that you look for in a young hitter like Harrison. What's your plan going to the plate? Read the field. Just take that ball deep to second base, score the run.
Now with the bases empty and 2 down, the first pitch to Mehta misses for ball 1. That also closes the line on Girardi, who faced just 1 hitter, it turns out, and is charged for 1 run on 1 hit. Harrison, or rather Esquivel, the responsibility of Robles, who struck him out, steals a strike here to even the count at 1 against Medem, the shortstop, who's 1 of 2 with a base hit and a K. That was against Acosta. So again for Girardi, no innings, didn't record an out. Gave up a run on the hit, no walks, no Ks. And he'll leave with a no decision as Robles misses for ball 2. So back tied at 5, although the Rebels have done it on 11 hits to St. Mary's 5 knocks. One of them a long ball, the only home run of the game from Almanza in the 1st. Overhand breaking pitch from Robles, in over the outside for strike 2. Count even as Robles out of Moreno Valley, California, takes the sign, deals out of the full line. Breaking ball outside, 3 balls and 2 strikes to the 9 hitter in the lineup. And with the leadoff man Napier on deck, Robles just about has to be in the zone here.
Yeah, and you got to go after him. You don't want to get back to the top of the inning and then knowing Almanza's on deck.
Here's the 3-2 payoff pitch as Almanza, or rather Robles, sets and fires. Swing and a miss for strike 3. Robles strikes out 2 of the 3 that he faces in the inning and threw 5.5 after St. Mary's plates 3 runs on 2 hits in the inning. It's all tied up, 5-5, as Ryland Charles, the leadoff man, leads off the 6th here from Earl E. Wilson Stadium, coming up next.
Lady Rebel fans, head over to Parkway Tavern Flamingo to watch UNLV take on the Creighton Blue Jays in the 1st round of the NCAA March Madness Tournament. Tip-off is at 4 p.m., so be sure to get there early.
We're gonna have to I can't stand you. Put my feet on tape like you bust a grape. Then you hold the weight and you haven't met the apes.
Hustlin' Rebel Baseball is brought to you by Desert Radiology, the premier radiology practice in Nevada, providing the highest quality of diagnostic and interventional imaging for over 50 years. Radiology provider and partner of the Valley Health System Hospitals, UMC, and Southwest Medical Associates. Trusted community partner of the Golden Knights, the Aces, the Lights, the Aviators, and an official partner of UNLV Athletics. Matt Neverett along with Dan Dolby from Earl E. Wilson Stadium. UNLV comes to bat in the bottom of the sixth, all knotted up against St. Mary's. 5-5 tie, thanks to a three spot for the visiting Gales in the top of the sixth inning. Two of the runs charged to Acosta, one to Girardi, and it was Albert Robles able to get all three outs in the inning. First pitch from Ryan Wiltse in his second inning out of the St. Mary's bullpen, in for called strike one to Ryland Charles, who's one of three. He's grounded out to second twice and doubled, did that in the second by pulling it down the right field side. He takes inside here and the count goes even. J.P. Heft on deck. Isaac Rodriguez, third batter here in the bottom half of inning number six. Wiltse, it was a curveball just away. Charles moves ahead, two balls and a strike. This is the first of a two-game series between UNLV and St. Mary's. Mentioned it earlier. A 2:05 first pitch tomorrow as the Gales will wrap things up and head home for their first conference series next weekend. Charles pushes a bunt down the third base line. Rolling just foul. It's touched up by Pierce in front of the bag. Good decision by Charles. Nearly successful. He missed that one by about an inch.
You know, we talked about the last inning where Bear Harrison came up with a good plan. Infield back. He was able to get that runner moved across the plate. You know, young guys have to think about the game. They need to slow it down. A guy like Ryland, everything becomes so natural to him as a veteran, and a number of the players in the Rebel lineup and roster can do the same thing. Ryland's just one of those heady players, and he's going to take advantage of third baseman playing behind the bag.
He takes that one high in the count. Goes even at 2. Charles, or rather 3-2. Charles trying to get back to the batting average from 2 years ago when he was in the high 350s. Hits this one off the hand, shallow to right field. Coming in is Schmidt. And on the move, the right fielder gloves it over the head for out number one as Charles moves to 1-for-4. And that'll bring up J.P. Heft, who has scored twice after two base hits and a stolen base. Got plenty of other games going on between Mountain West teams.
Yeah, we've got a lot of action tonight. Air Force is at Texas, which has been a traditional trip down to Austin for the Air Force baseball team over the years. They're up 5-3, and Air Force leads the Mountain West at 5-1 record.
Half drives one the other way. Over into the gap in right center is Coleman Schmidt as he settles underneath it for out number two. Couple of pop-outs to right, and the Rebels with two up and two away in the sixth. Isaac Rodriguez now in, 1-for-3 with an RBI base hit his last time up.
New Mexico, New Mexico State, inter-state rivalry there. New Mexico comes up on top, 14-4. That was a final. University of Santa Clara is somebody that Gales are very familiar with and we're used to as we played them last weekend as that ball is called strike. Santa Clara plays San Jose, so another Mountain West WCC matchup. Santa Clara leads San Jose 7-1 in the bottom of the fifth.
Neil Wanda Rodriguez is chopped foul.
And then as we look up north to Reno, where the Hustle Rebels will be facing them in a three-game series this weekend in conference, they trail Sacramento State 15-8 in Sacramento. Top of four.
Hornets a really, really solid program. As Rodriguez waves and misses at strike three. Nowhere near that breaking ball outside. Second K for Wiltse is out number three in the sixth. He's now retired the last five Rebels he's faced. And through six innings full, it's UNLV and St. Mary's tied at 5.
Rebels fans, mark your calendar for April 6th when your UNLV football team will host its Spring Showcase at Allegiant Stadium. The Spring Showcase is free and open to the public, so we hope to see you there.
Come on, Dad.
At the plate, number two, Gavin Napier.
Getting into the late stages of this midweek non-conference showdown between UNLV and St. Mary's. We're all tied at five. Top of the seventh begins with the top of the lineup for the Gales is Gavin Napier, Christian Almanza, and Ryan Pierce, the top three hitters. And Eric Valenzuela's lineup lead it off against Albert Robles, who came in and got all three outs in the sixth inning. Two strikeouts and a ground out that scored a run off the bat of Bear Harrison to tie the game. Napier swings to the first pitch and pops it up on the right side of the infield. A couple of steps in for Austin Krizik. Now a lunge to the right as Kriz stabs it over the right shoulder for out number one. So far, so good for Robles. He's retired all four batters he's faced.
That's a big out right there. First pitch swing and pops it up. One down here with the dangerous Almanza coming up. You know, he goes long early, does strike out against Robles last inning. He'll be looking for contact here.
This is the challenge, and he starts him out backwards, throwing that breaking pitch over the outside. Steals a strike from Almanza. Almanza had that K against Acosta, but and shouldn't feel too bad. He was striking out just about everybody. Seven of the 9 outs that Joey recorded were via the K. Almanza chops it to the right side, sliding and off the glove of the first baseman. It's into right field as Krizik couldn't handle it. Almanza with a base hit with one out here in the seventh.
Yeah, that's a pitch right there that's deep into the hole. You almost want Krizik to back off that because it looks like J.P. Heft is going to get there in time, albeit on the grass. That would enable Krizik to get back to first for an easy flip. But, you know, as the ball's hit like that, it's a judgment call. You got to jump early. You got to make a good break on it. So sometimes it's just a judgment call and ends up being a base hit.
Ryan Pierce two up. He's 0 for 3. Swings at the first pitch and comes up empty on an elevated changeup. That last play, one of the rare examples so far, Dan, of Austin Krizik not looking 100% comfortable at first. Remember, this is the first year he's ever played first base in his entire life.
Yeah, and that's probably the first time I've ever seen him look uncomfortable this season.
Yeah, he's been excellent in an unfamiliar spot is the count. Now, no balls and two strikes. Pierce takes a fastball. Yeah, just remarkable. And we brought it up ad nauseum at the beginning of the year. Austin Krizik, a standout in the local baseball scene, really from the time that he could swing a bat. He was a phenomenal outfielder. His pitch down and away on 0-2. Krizik had been a center fielder or a left fielder on just about every team that he had ever played for. And as a left-handed thrower, you know, your options are limited position-wise.
Correct.
First base is one of the primary ones. Here's the 1-2. Fouled straight back. Able to stay alive is Pierce, who has struck out twice and grounded out to Heft in the fifth.
But we've brought it up many times. One of the few guys that's left-handed thrower, but a right-handed batter. And I've talked to him about that over the years, and he says he just never felt comfortable from that side of the plate.
Some guys just see it better.
Mm-hmm.
There is a front and back eye dominant testing process you can go through. As a foul ball keeps the count, 1-2.
I know quite a few golfers like that, too. They'll be right-hand dominant, but they feel more comfortable with a left-handed swing.
So that's me. I golf lefty, as you know, but it's because I grew up swinging a baseball bat lefty and didn't pick up a golf club until I was like 15 or 16.
Yep.
So, I mean, that explains that, but I'm the weird one in that example. Another 1-2. A rollover ground ball up the middle. Miro's got it. Steps on the bag. Shortstop's throw to first is in time. And a 6-3 twin killing wraps up what turns into a 1-2-3 top of the seventh. The smooth fielding. Paul Miro the fourth. Ends the seventh nearly single-handedly. It's stretch time in Las Vegas. Get up, move around. When we come back, it'll be the bottom of the seventh inning. UNLV and St. Mary's tied at five. Cade Higgins to lead things off for the Hustlin' Rebels next.
Stretch your neck, stretch your back, and let's hear you sing Take Me Out to the Ball Game. Thank you.
Leading off the bottom of the seventh for UNLV, number 14, Cade Higgins.
Coming out of the stretch break in the bottom of the seventh inning, still tied at five. Matt Everett along with Dan Dolby bringing you all the action between UNLV and St. Mary's. Cade Higgins to lead things off against Ryan Wiltsey, pitching for a third inning out of the bullpen. Gets a hefty cut and a big miss from Higgins, who has singled and grounded out twice, the second of which was off the hip of Jason Wrights, and with a 6'9" right-hander, a good play to come off the mound and retire the side. Higgins recorded the final out of the fourth, swings and misses. At another pitch, this one an elevated fastball. He's quickly behind nothing and two with Krizik behind him. Schmidt hitting third in the seventh. Infield a step to the right all the way around. Way off the bag at third is Pierce. We'll see out of the full wind, bounces a curveball. Higgins watching all the way. He was expecting that one coming.
Yeah, Higgy's a fastball hitter, although he missed on the previous pitch. I don't think you're going to see a lot more fastballs coming up in the next couple pitches from Wiltsey.
Maybe not to the next couple of batters as the Rebels filter through the power part of their lineup. Higgins swings and misses. That one looked like a changeup fading away from him. And Wiltsey struck out Rodriguez to end the sixth. Strikes out Higgins to start the seventh. That's his third K in what is now 2 1/3 innings tossed. There's a Boston Krizik from the right side. We were talking about the fact that he throws lefty, bats righty. So does another guy that got mentioned earlier in the broadcast. And the tie-in goes back to Jason Wrights. That was where Randy Johnson batted.
Randy Johnson, yeah.
With that giant pad on the left elbow. This one's popped up way high, pretty shallow to right center. Here comes Coleman Schmidt, the right fielder, to call off the second baseman Napier. And Krizik, after an aggressive hack on a first pitch fastball, pops out to right, quickly two up and two away. That's seven straight set down by Wiltsey.
Here comes Schmidt, looking for his fourth hit in the night. You know, he's new to the lineup this year. So grad transfer to the Rebels. I'm not sure what they're calling him, but right now this kid's automatic.
The infield moves a step to the left, although he hits it just as proficiently the opposite way. He takes high. He's 3-for-3. A base hit in each of his first two at-bats. Drove in a run when he singled in the first. He doubled in the fifth and came around to score on a Santino Pinaro base hit off the glove of the first baseman Almanza. He swings and misses at that pitch above the chest, fouling it back into the mitt of Harrison as he does so. He was trying to drive that thing down into the left field corner.
That's a big cut. Just got out in front of it a little.
Nobody up behind Wiltsey in the bullpen. He had started 8 games each of the last 2 years. This is his 8th relief outing of the year. Still no starts as he steals a strike up in the zone to move it 1-2. He threw a season high 4 shutout innings against San Jose State in his last time out 1 week ago today in another non-conference showdown against a Mountain West opponent. The 1-2's in the dirt, easily watched by Schmidt, and the count goes even. That outing, by the way, season best 6 strikeouts on a season-long 4 innings. He didn't allow a base runner in a 7-1 St. Mary's win. 12 up, 12 down, half of them set down via the strikeout. The 2-2, swung on and missed. Second straight 1-2-3 inning by Wiltsey gets him through 3 innings. He's given up a run on 2 hits, although none since that second hit. Rebels down in order. We're on to the 8th. It's all tied up at 5 between UNLV and St. Mary's.
UNLV fans, the Hustlin' Rebels will be back at home tomorrow, March 20th, for the finale of this two-game set against the St. Mary's Gales. First pitch is set for 2:05 p.m., so be sure to get here early. That's tomorrow, March 20th, 2:05 p.m., right here, Early Wilson Stadium.
Rebel Baseball is presented by Parkway Tavern, official partner of UNLV Athletics and your home for Rebels on the road. With over 250 beers, 24/7 gaming, and seven Valley locations, there's no better place to catch the game than Parkway Tavern. My favorite is the one on Flamingo and 215. Coleman Schmidt leads things off in the eighth against Albert Robles, who has been divine through two full innings, six up and six down, including a base hit and an inning-ending double play turned by Paul Miro to end the seventh. First pitch swinging is Schmidt, and he lines one into center field for a base hit. Second knock that Robles has given up. It's the second hit of the day for Schmidt, who had struck out twice and has now doubled and singled in his most recent at-bats. In a 5-5 game, tying run on to lead off the eighth. It is the fourth leadoff hitter to reach in eight innings now. And it brings up Ryan Duroff, who has not recorded a hit, but has not been retired either. Two walks and a hit batter. He's also scored a run, including as part of that three-run sixth inning. Schmidt off first with a big lead. He's 3-for-4 in stolen base attempts on the year. Stays near the base here as Robles spins a slider outside to Duroff for ball one.
You mentioned Parkway Tavern. Tomorrow, after the Rebel baseball game, hustle on up to the Flamingo location, your favorite location.
My number one.
Watch party for the Runner Rebel basketball men playing in the NIT.
Runner breaks, then stops. Pitch popped up straight back. That'll find the seats and move the count 1-1. Yeah, interesting matchup. Princeton Tigers. They run, of course, the Princeton offense, one of the staples of a lot of East Coast teams. One of the things UNLV is going to have to look out for, a lot of backdoor cuts.
Yep.
And a lot of triangle-based offense a la Phil Jackson. A lot of elements of the Princeton and his triangle offense. Throw to first, sends Schmidt diving it back ahead of the throw safely.
Well, you always appreciate that offense. Same thing that Air Force runs, right? Don't have necessarily have the best athletes to match up. They're going to scheme you.
It helps that they don't run a super deep rotation. That's one of the hallmarks of Princeton. They really only run about seven deep. Line drive over the head of the third baseman and into left field. That one not all that hard hit, but it did the job. Rounding second and sliding in safely at third base. As the throw goes behind him as Coleman Schmidt heads up baseball. The third base coach with the rotator cuff looking to get checked out after that one. He was sending him before he even was halfway to second base. And Schmidt on the same page. That puts runners in the corners.
Now batting number
and
three,
in a tie game, we'll get a pinch runner at first. Number 44, Tanner Griffith, pinch running at first base. Griffith pinch running for Duroff.
Good aggressive base running right there by the Gales. Schmidt was, to your point, rolling all the way, and Schmidt went to a head first slide 15 feet out from the bag. So gives the Gales runners at the corners with no outs here.
Dalton Mayshore stands in there with two on and nobody out. 1-for-3, including an RBI double. Part of that three-run sixth. He squares to bunt, pulls it back on a pitch that misses outside. So interesting with runners in the corners. And the count now 1-0. What do you do here from a defensive positioning standpoint? Because there are options.
Well, I can tell you what they're lined up for. It doesn't mean they won't stem into something different. But right now, they're going to concede the run for a double play.
Still nobody out in the inning. It's Mayshore. Pulls back another bunt attempt. This one nearly got him in the chest. In the count, two balls and no strikes. For Robles here, he's going to be thinking up. It is harder to bunt something high on the ground. And if he does have command of that breaking pitch to be able to throw it, something that starts high and drops into the zone, it makes it even tougher to change the bat level on a bunt.
Well, that's how you get a batter to pop it up.
Batter doesn't square around here. Instead, Mayshore takes ball three high on a fastball. So Robles behind, three balls, no strikes. A walk here is not the worst. You've got the DH Esquivel coming up in what would be his second plate appearance. Robles would much, much rather throw the strike here on 3-0. And he does. Fires one over the outside third, and it's a called strike one.
Yeah, I understand the philosophy there, but I'm not in that camp. And the reason is anything hit hard, got to be a play at the plate to get that forced runner. You know, if you're trying to keep the runner in,
runner breaks from first as the batter swings and misses at strike two. Stolen base for Griffith with no throw. It's runners on second and third. So now no double play, and looks like the infield's going to draw themselves all the way in across the board.
Yeah, this is going to change everything for Coach Stolte and his defensive alignment here. They're going to try to keep everything in the infield, make the play at the plate.
Curveball just above the letters for ball four to load the bases. And that didn't miss by much. Robles thought it was strike two. Instead, Mayshore on for the second straight plate appearance. And the bases are loaded with nobody out.
Chris Escobel.
Robles got to work his way out of a jam here. Comes in with the game tied. This is one of the situations where he got himself in trouble at New Mexico a week and a half ago.
Yeah, that game where he had walked two. Season high five walks against Pacific in a 6-5 UNLV win. Since then, coming into the game, he had walked just three. Even with that, he's only walked four. First pitch swinging is the Descavel. Grounded to second. Myro to the bag. The throw to first hits off the foot of the runner. Here comes the runner from third to the plate. He'll score easily. St. Mary's leads it 7-5 on a fielder's choice hit into by Escobel.
So situation right there. Infield pulled in. Ball hit towards second base on a two bouncer to Paul Myro. He did consider going home. Flipped it over. But throw to first base is errant. And that scores another one on a throwing error by the second baseman.
Yeah, so a throwing error for the second baseman accounts for Duroff scoring. And so the runner on first is Escobel. This pitch underneath Bailey Seager. And all the way to the backstop, a big turnaround second for Escobel, but he'll have to be content with a 90-foot advancement. You would assume wild pitch, right? That one between the wickets, but close.
Between the wickets, yeah, that's a wild pitch. That's balls in the dirt. But again, big mistake by Robles right there, allowing the runner to advance to second, keeping first base open, and the double play out of reach here.
So St. Mary's leads at 7-5. With one out here in the top half of inning number eight, the late stages of this game. And on 1-0, Robles deals way upstairs to Harrison. So again, fielder's choice for Escobel. 6-4, the put out of Mayshore up the middle. No RBI as Schmidt scores, and then the throwing error by the second baseman Heft, allowing Duroff to score from third. Wild pitch, then moving Escobel up to second. Here's the 2-0. Line to the right side, lunging and stabbing it is J.P. Heft for the out. Back to the base at second is Escobel. What a play. Great reaction from Heft and a better dive for the out.
Excellent play by second baseman J.P. Heft there. He was actually shading towards the bag, faking the runner at second, holding him on the bag tighter. And he actually was on the move as that ball was hit, able to get out and stretch out and get that one for the second out. We're going to get another pitching change here. Coach Stolte coming out, taking the ball. We'll get you a new pitcher here shortly.
Yeah, Matthew Maloney coming jogging out of the right field bullpen. Maloney set to make his second outing in as many games for UNLV. He'll try and stop the bleeding. St. Mary's plating two runs on two hits so far in the inning. Maloney will face off against the number nine man in the lineup, Jared Mehta, when we return here in the eighth inning.
Ladies and gentlemen, taking the hill for the Rebels, number 11, Matt Maloney.
We'll be right back.
Here's Matthew Maloney, the New Mexico State transfer, into a 7-5 game as Maloney comes in behind Robles. That's a face-off against the bottom hitter in St. Mary's lineup, Jared Medham, who is 1-3, has struck out in each of his last two at-bats. The runner on second is Esquivel, as he came in as a pinch hitter earlier, reached on a fielder's choice, and as Bear Harrison lined out for the second out of the inning. That'll bring up Medham. Austin Krizik, meanwhile.
No, we have a pinch hitter here, Torek. Number 31.
Number 31, Aiden Torek. Torek pinch hitting for Medham at the bottom of the lineup. Krizik had to get something looked at on the glove. So he's back in at first. 31, Torek pinch hitting here with two outs in a two-run game in the top of the eighth inning. Torek in from the right. First pitch from Maloney. Just off the inside for a called ball one. Torek, the 5'11 redshirt freshman out of Santa Ana, California. Find him at the racetrack, watching the ponies at Santa Ana. He swings here and grounds it to short. Up with it is Miro, and the shortstop's throw to first is down the line. Krizik off the bag and applying the tag for the final out of the eighth inning. There were two runs in the frame, one of which was earned on two hits. There was one error and one runner left on base. All of a sudden, after a two spot, St. Mary's leads it after 7.5, 7-5. Bottom third of the UNLV lineup looks to start the comeback trail coming up next.
2-1, it's time to give. Help us rally for UNLV on March 24th during Rebels Give. Join the UNLV community in making a powerful impact by supporting what you love at UNLV. Visit rebelsgive.unlv.edu for ideas on how you can make an impact.
It was a clear black night, a clear white moon. Roman G was on the streets, trying to consume some scratch from the east, so I could get some phones rolling on my ride, chilling all alone.
Just hit the east side of the LBC. On a mission trying to find Mr. Warren G. Seen a car full of girls, ain't no need to tweak. Only you search for what's up with 213. So I hooked
select. Ladies and gentlemen, your attention, please. Taking the hill for the Gales is number 17, Preston Howie.
I said, what's up? Some brothers put some gas, so I said, I'm
sick. Since these girls peeping me, I'm gonna glide and swerve. These hookers looking so hard, they straight hit the curve. Want to pick up better things than some horny tricks. I see my homie and some suckers all in his mix.
Defensive change for St. Mary. Now playing shortstop and batting ninth is number 9, Anthony Familia.
They took my rings, they took my Rolex. I looked at the brother, said, damn, what's next?
They got my homie hemmed up, and they all around. Gave them up, seeing if they don't.
Staying in the game and now playing left field is number 40. For Tanner Griffin. He'll be batting in the fifth spot.
They got guns to my head. I think I'm going down. I can't believe it's happening in my own town. If I had wings, I would fly. Let me contemplate. I glance in the cup and I see my homie name.
16 in the clip and one in the hole. Nate Dogg is about to make somebody's turn cold. Now they dropping and yelling. It's a tad bit late. Nate Dogg and Warren G had to regulate.
Leading off the bottom of the eighth for UNLV, number 8, Santino Panaro.
Santino Panaro to lead things off in the bottom of the eighth inning. All of a sudden, the Rebels trailing 7-5. And new arm on the hill for St. Mary's is number 17, Preston Howie, spelled H-O-W-E-Y. Howie pitching with a lead. Comes in behind Ryan Wiltsey, who's the pitcher of record for the Gales. They're on top 7-5 in the eighth inning as Santino Panaro takes the first pitch fastball at the letters for a strike from the 5'10" right-handed senior, Preston Howie. Howie, so far on the year, 1-1 with a 3.97 earned run average. He misses up hard-throwing right-hander, but missed way high there to even the count at one. Matthew Maloney able to get the final out of the eighth inning, coming in behind Albert Robles.
Howie does have two saves this year.
20 strikeouts as well in 11 and a third innings. Missing a lot of bats as this one's popped up foul and out of play down the left field side. Opponents hitting just 205 against him this year as well. UNLV with 5 runs on 11 hits. St. Mary's has been more efficient, 7 runs on 8 hits. Robles charged for 2 runs, one of them earned on 3 hits over 2 and a third innings. 2 and 2/3 rather. as Pinaro takes outside. Count goes even at two. And Robles on the hook for the loss if the score were to hold at this point. Santino, two for three so far. A couple of RBIs on a couple of base hits. Comes after he popped out to left to end the first inning in his first time up. Watches a pitch at the shoot tops for ball three, and he's worked the count full against Preston Howie.
Howie came in, first pitch, fastball, 93 miles an hour.
Our thrower who does the first base side of the slab, he'll deal out of the full windup on 3-2 to the leadoff man, Pinaro. He swings, hits it right back off the leg of the pitcher. Howie behind the hill, throwing to first, it's not in time. A base hit for Pinaro, a painful one for Howie, and they're gonna come out and take a look at it.
That ball looked like it went off his left hand with glove hand. He was able to stop that, but the ball trailed away from him towards second base, and Pinaro runs well, was able to get in there. So the medical staff from St. Mary's is going to take a trot out there. He's shaking his hand. He's still shaking that thing.
As they look at the top of the hand, yeah, hot shot, no doubt about it, by Pinaro. And that was one where Howie tried to get out of the way. A lot of times you'll see pitchers try to put a body part in the way, knock it down. Not there. Howie was trying to get out of the way.
Self-preservation right there. Just couldn't get out of the way.
It was
again,
blasted.
Second real hard hit ball that we've seen tonight from Pinaro. So hopefully his bat's starting to heat up again. Nice to have him up at the 330, 335 mark that we saw him at a couple years ago.
And he matches a season high with his third hit of the year. Only other game in which he's accomplished that feat was on the ninth against New Mexico. It was 3-5 in a UNLV loss. Rebels swept in Albuquerque. He's on first. Brings up Bailey Seager representing the tying run. Seager takes a breaking pitch outside from Howie and moves ahead. Howie has now surrendered 10 hits in 11 and a third innings. As mentioned, 20 strikeouts to just 5 walks. Missed a lot of bats. He's improved every year as well. He has pitched exclusively out of the pen over his four-year career. This is high to move at 2-0. Appearance number 57, he has made exactly zero starts.
We've seen Pinaro aggressive twice on the base path tonight. This situation, though, trailing by two, I don't think you're going to see a lot of aggressiveness from a stolen base standpoint.
They throw over there just in case. Back in ahead of the throw is Pinaro. Meanwhile, a couple of defensive substitutions to update you on. Anthony Pamilia comes in as a defensive replacement. Yeah, at shortstop, Tanner Griffith takes over in left field. Griffith pinch ran for Durov as part of that two-run eighth inning. Seager hits the ground ball, left side fair. Foul ball, foul ruled by Jim Courtney down the third base side. Peek behind the curtain here. There is a red stanchion, big pole right in front of us that rarely, I will say, comes into play. That was one where the umpire was behind it.
Sitting to your left a little bit, I had a...
You saw the angle.
Had an angle. Didn't get a lot of argument from third base coach Kevin Higgins, so I think they had the better view than we did tonight.
At least than me.
Yeah.
Which isn't saying much with the pull right in the way of the umpire. Seager on the follow-up pitch swings and misses at a slider.
And those poles that were put in, that was post-building back in the 80s of this stadium for the shade structure here. So no place to put them, right in your face.
And the shade structure is imperative.
Phenomenal.
Can't not have that here. It's beautiful this time of year. Will get hot when the season ends in May. On 2-2, Seager, it's a ground ball to the left side. To his right is Pamilia. The feed to second is there. Throw to first gets by the first baseman Almanza on a throwing error. Nowhere. He was going to be safe anyway. So it is a fielder's choice, 6-4 on the putout. Good for Pamilia to get the lead runner. That was a slow hit ball and a tough play. Bang, bang at the base.
Yeah, he made a good job of getting over there, staying down. That ball really never came up off the turf. He was able to get down there on the shoelaces, make a good relay off of throw, just the knuckles, just off the dirt. Relay would not have gotten Seager, but nonetheless, they record the lead run out.
So Paul Miro standing just outside the right-handed batter's box. Stan Stolte out in front of the dugout. Everybody just kind of waiting. Are they going to make a substitution? Somebody just jogged down to the bullpen and right. Home plate umpire Ryan Wilson had the notepad out. Looked like he was going to write something down. And yeah, that pitch runner snuck out there. Pitch runner snuck out as Gunnar Myro will pitch run for Seager. Interesting. So we'll
batting
see
in front of his brother right now at the plate.
His brother Paul, the older of the two Myros. Watches as they throw it. Younger brother Gunner at first base. He's able to get back in there safely. So Seager out. We'll likely see Chase Gallegos doing the catching in the top of the ninth, but we'll see. Gunner off of first. Paul at the plate. It's a Miro party in the eighth as Paul takes a slider in through the front door from Howie for a called strike.
Yeah, Gunner, the freshman from Bishop Gorman High School, highly touted, signed after his junior year with the Hustlin' Rebels and be a big part of the Rebel offense going forward.
Ball swings and misses at the elevated heater and is behind nothing and two. They've used Gunner in just about every imaginable spot.
Yeah, he's going to be that Swiss Army knife for them the first couple of years in his career here until he finds a home, but he's eventually going to find some place to really be able to excel it.
On 0-2, Miro, the one at the plate, takes a called ball just off the outside. Paul 0-3, looking for his first hit of the day. A pair of ground outs to Pierce at third, followed by a strikeout in the fifth against Wiltsey, who finishes as the pitcher of record. One run on two hits, no walks, and four strikeouts over three innings. Here's the 1-2 as Howie deals from the stretch. Miro goes down and swings and misses at a pitch just off the dirt. So out number two comes via the K, second of the day for Miro. And with younger brother Gunner on first, here comes Ryland Charles at the top of the lineup. 1-for-4 thus far, representing the tying run. Time running out for UNLV as they trail 7-5 with two outs and a runner on in the bottom of the eighth inning.
But if you're down to your last four outs, these are the first four you want up.
Ryland Charles swings at the first pitch and fouls it straight back. Ryland's been super aggressive this year, and he was never a passive hitter in there, but he's really ratcheted up his aggressiveness in the first pitch.
I was watching him and taking BP today. He's really choked up even more than he usually is. I don't know if that's just an adjustment he feels a little more comfortable with, or he still generates a ton of power, though, with bat choked up like that, a little frame like that. But great hips, great shoulder turn, hands follow. Good opportunity for him right now to take advantage of those skills.
A lot of times guys just like to shift the weight of the bat. They like to keep a little bit more weight below the handle. You see the guys like Joey Votto in the big leagues with a hockey puck knob, as they call it. Fitting, the Canuck Joey Votto now signing with the Toronto Blue Jays on a minor league deal.
But you don't see that very much as players go through a count either. You used to see back in the old days, everybody sat down on the knob, but as they more strikes came on, the higher they went up on the knob.
Counts 1-1 to Charles. Beautiful backdoor pitch from Howie in for strike two.
But the major league game has changed.
Very much so.
If you hit 50 home runs and you strike out 150, 175 times, you're going to make a pretty good living.
That's the Kyle Schwarber special right there.
Yeah.
On 2-2, Howie to the dish. Charles pops it up. Left side, shallow in the outfield. Coming in is Griffith in fair territory. The left fielder has it for out number three. The Rebels, after a leadoff single, unable to capitalize, and will enter into the ninth inning with a 7-5 deficit, UNLV trailing St. Mary's.
Rebel fans, the 2024 UNLV football season tickets are now up for sale. So head over to UNLVtickets.com to purchase your tickets for next season's football season right now. Defensive changes for the Rebels. Now catching is number 10, Chase Gallegos. Gallegos will be batting in the eighth spot. She caught the fits. I did that time and spent that bread. I made it home. I'm almost there. I'm on my way. Headed up the stairs. To my surprise, they're replacing me. I had to take them to that ghetto university.
St. Mary's on top of UNLV, 7-5. Entering into the top of inning number 9. Gales with their last ups trying to add on. Matthew Maloney staying in the game. He came in and Got the final out of the eighth. We'll try to get all three outs of the ninth. Leading off the second baseman, Gavin Napier. He walked to lead off the game on a four-pitch at-bat from starter Noah Carbajal and has not reached base since. He takes a strike from Maloney and falls behind nothing and one. Everything in the air for Napier tonight. Line out to right, a fly ball in foul territory to right, and a pop-up to Krizek at first in fair territory in the seventh. Napier leans away from this pitch inside by Maloney. And for UNLV, unable to capitalize on another leadoff runner reaching in the bottom of the eighth inning. Santino Panaro reached via the hip. Maloney out of the stretch. Converted catcher. Deals just high, maybe a bit inside. And Napier goes ahead 3-0.
Yeah, if you're Maloney, what you don't want to give us a free pass right here. Bring Almanza up. Runner in on first base with no outs.
Maloney right down the middle. That fastball in for strike one.
Right now, you're just trying to keep that deficit at two. We know that the Rebels have the batting order coming up to score some, generate some runs, but can't give up any more right now.
Maloney looking to come all the way back. He sets, he fires. This one's grounded left side. Diving is the third baseman, and it's past Rodriguez into left field for a base hit. Another leadoff runner on, as now 5 of 9 leadoff men have reached for the Gales. And as you had mentioned, Dan, this is not what you wanted to happen. Runner on, nobody out for Christian Almanza, who's 3 of 4 today and 27 of 64 on the year.
A scary proposition right here if you're a pitching coach. Don't want to give him anything to hit, but also don't want to put a lead runner on at second via the walk.
First pitch in the dirt. Almanza, who entered this game batting 400, now batting 422 after three hits and four at-bats, including his ninth home run of the year in the first. Short lead for Napier off the base. So Almanza skies one out of play beyond the left field bleacher seats.
Yeah, that's a big cut. He's looking to extend it by two right away.
And he looks as comfortable at the plate as anybody in college baseball. The only left-hander in the lineup tonight for seventh-year head coach Eric Valenzuela. The 1-1 from Maloney. In the dirt, gets all the way past the new catcher into the game, Chase Gallegos. Wild pitch advancing Napier. Really no shot for Gallegos there. Maloney had an issue with the grip. He chunked that thing 55 feet in front of the plate. So Napier now in scoring position with nobody out. Just in case, Paul Miro keeping eyes on him. In the back pocket, it's short. 2-1 the count to Christian Almanza, one of the top power hitters on the West Coast. He takes a pitch outside in the count, 3-1. Maloney sitting 92-93 with the fastball. He also throws that cutter, which is a unique pitch at the college level at least. Well, just about everybody adding it in the professional ranks. Almanza hits one high in the air, but playable to left. A couple of steps back and now into Santino Panaro. In front of the warning track, he gloves it on a lunge. Tagging at second, not advancing is Napier. That thing hung up there for quite some time. And Almanza, it's the first time today that he's put a ball in play and not reached.
Yeah, that's a pitch that Maloney kind of got away with one. Also one that Almanza probably wants back. Didn't miss by much. That ball carried in the night sky with no wind here. That was a throw that Panaro made. I'd like to see him hit the cutoff on that. He tried to throw all the way to third base. So, situation like that, you just can't give the Gales any more lead base runners on third as opposed to second right now. Sacrifice gets another run in.
Ryan Pierce ahead, 1-1, no strikes. He's hitless today, 0-4. 2 strikeouts, 2 groundouts, including a double play ball. He takes up again, and Maloney, when he misses, that's the miss, is trying to overthrow it and kind of almost like a golfer on his driver where you got to angle the shoulders a little bit. He really starts to lean back when he tries to overthrow. Foul ball, rather a fastball, I should say, at the letters in for a strike.
Yeah, that's a good point because the stride doesn't look as long on those, and he's got his weight back a little bit, and that's why that ball is coming out of his hand high.
That one's high but foul back. Pierce obliging on a pitch up out of the zone, and Maloney with the count even at 2-2. Maloney pulls with that left front side so hard. I mean, he is a violent delivery converted catcher, and you can tell he's got a really short arm slot as well. Basically fires it from the ear. Looking for a strikeout here. Instead, it's a line drive to second. Over to his left to glove it is J.P. Heft. Back to the base is Gavin Napier. Second line out that Heft has snagged, having to go a little ways to get it. And after a leadoff single, followed by a wild pitch, a pop out and a line out bring up Coleman Schmidt with a runner on second and two down. St. Mary's on top 7-5. In the bottom of the ninth, the Rebels will send up Heft, Rodriguez, and Higgins, the 2-3-4 spots. And they hope to send a couple more up to the plate with a rally as Gallegos goes out to the mound.
Coleman Schmidt having a good night, too. Coleman Schmidt from St. Mary's and Parker Schmidt from the Rebels tonight combined have 5 hits. Job right now for Maloney is to make sure that the Gale doesn't extend that streak.
The Gale and the Rebel, the battle of the Schmidts. UNLV with 5 runs on 12 hits, 7 runs on 9 hits for St. Mary's. Each side has committed one error, has the pitching coach Corey Vanderhook out to have a word. This likely to game plan, correct?
Yeah, that he trotted out there. He wasn't walking to waste any time.
He doesn't do that often either.
No.
So Vanderhook back to the dugout. That's the first mound visit used by UNLV. Anytime that Stan Stolte had gone out there, he had pulled the pitcher, including Acosta, who had left with an injury after 3 really solid innings, 7 strikeouts, a season high. First pitch to Coleman Schmidt. Breaking ball that looked like it fooled him. He takes it for a called strike 1.
It's a shame with Acosta tonight. Rolling along so well. Really needed the good night. And he did have a good night. Just had to exit early. Hopefully nothing major for him.
Swing and a miss from Schmidt. And the count nothing and 2. Schmidt struck out in each of his first 2 at-bats. Since then, he's doubled and singled, scoring both times. The Rebels, since Acosta has left the game, have amassed a total of 2 strikeouts, both by Robles. That could change now. As a pop-up to right field sends Higgins towards the corner. Higgins on the warning track stops and makes the catch at the chest. That thing sent him a long ways, but Kate Higgins up to the task. Leadoff single goes for naught. And coming up in the bottom of the ninth inning, J.P. Heft, Isaac Rodriguez, and Kate Higgins, the first 3 batters to try and get the Rebels back into this one. They need 2 to tie, 3 to walk it off and win. We'll see if they can do it coming up. It all comes down to this in the bottom of the ninth inning. St. Mary's leads UNLV 7-5 in the first game of a 2-week non-conference set. Preston Howie back out in a save situation for his second inning of work against J.P. Heft to lead it off. Heft, watching all the way, takes a front door slider. Beautiful pitch, perfect spot. And Howie ahead of Heft, no balls and a strike. J.P. Heft 2-for-4 tonight. He has singled, grounded out, singled and flied out. Swings and misses here and is behind nothing and 2, although he's got that pattern working for him. If the pattern holds up, he's due for a hit.
And it would be opposite field.
Yeah, just about all of them are. He's got 29 hits on the year. Next one will be his team leading 30th. He hopes it's here in the ninth as he takes a bouncing pitch on nothing and 2. So far, so good for Howie, who came in and got all 3 outs in the eighth, gave up a hit, and struck out a batter doing so. Here's Miro for out number two. On 1-2, he deals out of the full windup. Going the other way, here is Heft, but foul. And just over the fence and leaving the yard in right field in front of the clubhouse.
Yeah, 0-2 count, how he made a good pitch, exactly where Harrison wanted that pitch. Trying to get Heft to chase something out of the zone here. Imagine you're going to see something away from him again.
After a foul ball on 1-2, that pitch in the dirt. Good recognition there by Heft. He saw it out of the hand early. On deck is Isaac Rodriguez. If one of the two of them can reach, it brings up Higgins, Krizic, Schmidt, the top three RBI guys in the lineup. Your top extra base hit threats as well. Foul ball to stay alive as Heft reached up out of the zone to get it, knocking it straight down between the wickets of the catcher Harrison.
Heft doesn't seem to be cutting down his swing right now. He's still looking to drive something right here.
Right on right matchup in the bottom of the ninth. Here's the 2-2 from Preston Howie. Another foul ball, barely tipped straight back. You got Ryland Charles who chokes up on the bat no matter what. And then you got J.P. Heft, who has, you know, maybe two fingers below the knob and is taking daddy hacks, as they call him, on a 2-2 count in the bottom of the ninth.
Yeah, he's not getting cheated, but, I mean, you're not going to question what's been working for the young man.
As they say, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Heft doesn't need any fixing to this point. He's worked a long at bat on 2-2. Howie delivers again. This one's popped up right side of the infield. It's down. Almanza off the base. The throw to the second baseman. Not in time. An infield base hit for J.P. Heft brings the tying run to the plate in the bottom of the ninth. And Isaac Rodriguez, it's not always about how hard you hit it. In that case for Heft, it was about where and how hard.
That was just a fister that ended up behind the pitcher over towards second base. Second baseman made a great break over to first base as he realized that Almanza was coming off the bag. He just couldn't get there in time. Good running by Heft right there.
Heft hustling down the line. And a first pitch swing, a line drive base hit for Isaac Rodriguez has the tying run on base. How quickly an inning can turn.
Okay, I'm going to bring something up because this is a conversation I had with Higgy in the cages today. They always take their hacks. They always lay down a couple bunts. He laid down a bunt from his dad, the hitting coach, went foul. And his dad waved his arms like, you're better than that. And then I said, you know what's going to make your old man mad, right, is not getting a bunt down. He goes, I'm just hoping he doesn't ask me to bunt during a game. So here's the situation right now. Is this an opportunity for Higgins to put down a sacrifice bunt, knowing he's got the power against a right-handed pitcher? You know, this is the cat and mouse game, and this is why, you know, these coaches are so good at what they do. They've run these scenarios through their heads. They've watched film throughout the years, and a lot of it's just come down to experience,
yeah,
right? How you feel about the game. And I know Coach Higgins and Coach Stolte really go with the feel a lot of times.
And traditional knowledge would tell you, especially in the college game, runners on first and second, nobody out, automatic bunt situation. We'll see if that's the case here. You mentioned these coaches are good. Another thing they are is consistent.
Correct.
They will do one or the other and rarely, if ever, vary from their strategy.
Well,
that
would tell me that we're hitting away then.
We'll see. As Ryan Pierce, the third baseman, is even with the bag, he'll likely stay if a bunt is dropped down. No hold at first behind the runner as well. Almanza in front of Rodriguez as Cade Higgins stands in as the game's winning run in the bottom of the ninth inning. First pitch from Howie to Higgins. Down low, ball one. No inclination to bunt on that offering, at least from Cade.
Yeah, but a lot of times you'll see them not going up there showing bunt that first to see what the offering is.
There was a heater inside. Higgins is one of four. Singled and scored in the first, hitless since. On 1-0, Howie set looking at second. Gives another glance. Now deals. This one's off the outside. And Cade Higgins has worked himself into a premier hitter's count at 2-0 with nobody out as the game's winning run in the bottom of the ninth inning. Five runs, 14 hits for UNLV, 7-on-9 for the Gales. Here's the 2-0. Swung on and missed, a fastball right down the middle. Higgins would love to get that one again.
Yeah, he just absolutely challenged him right there, and Howie was the one that won that battle.
Strength on strength, to be sure. Now the pitch mix opens wide up for Howie. He can throw anything he wants here on 2-1. He's set on the center of the hill and deals. That fastball at the knees freezes Higgins as he takes a called strike two. And now the pitch mix more than open for Howie on 2-2.
Yeah, great sequence right there by Howie.
Hefton Rodriguez on second and first respectively after back-to-back hits in the ninth. Here's the 2-2 offering from Preston Howie. It swung on and fouled off. Higgins nearly falling over as he got a piece of that one.
Yeah, the one thing that right now you don't want to leave it to chance or leave it to an umpire. So anything close to the zone, Higgins going to try to get a piece of, stay alive in the count.
On deck is Austin Krizek. Higgins at the least trying to move the runners, at the most trying to win the game. After another foul ball, here's another 2-2 from Howie to Higgins. Swung on and missed for strike three. Going in on the shoe tops on a slider. Cade Higgins down on strikes for the second time in his last two at-bats, and that's a major first out with the double play active around the infield. Although due up next, Austin Krizek, a guy who does not hit a lot of ground balls at all.
No, this is a good opportunity right now to advance the runners, and also knowing you have Parker Schmidt behind you kind of lets you do a little bit more and be a little more free at the plate.
Austin Krizek was popped out to right in his last two at-bats after singling and walking early. Two on, one down in the ninth. He swings at the first pitch and torques one, but it's deep to right field and out of play on the roof of the clubhouse building. Krizek drove in a run on a base hit in the first, got the scoring started for the Rebels. It was a 2-2 tie after one. He then walked and scored in the third. That was the go-ahead run at that point in the game, though St. Mary's has since come back to take a 7-5 lead. The count, nothing and one, as Howie looks to second. Now deals to the dish. Krizek gets a ground ball to short. It's off the glove of the shortstop, Pamilia. Safe at second is Rodriguez. Everyone's safe everywhere on a costly error by Anthony Pamilia. A hard hit ball right at him. Taylor made twin killing that would have ended the game. But instead, the bases are loaded with one out for Parker Schmidt.
Yeah, hard hit ball, but concentration lapse just a little bit there. That would have been an easy 6-4-3 double play.
Now Schmidt with a chance to be the hero in a 7-5 game. He is 3-for-4 thus far. Swings and misses at a first pitch breaking ball. Man, he thought he had that one over the video board and left. Parker Schmidt, base hits in the first and the third, then a double inside the bag at third in the fifth. Struck out in the seventh against Wiltsy. It's a slider off the outside. That was the same exact pitch in the same spot as the previous offering, but Schmidt able to lay off there.
Looking at the alignment from the outfield right now, the Gales are pretty much playing straight up still. One out here.
Griffith very deep in left field, surprising with the tying run on second. Count 1-1. As Schmidt swings and misses, the back foot went flying as he swung and missed.
Yeah, that's the first time I've seen him kind of bail with the back foot on that one and try to reach for it. He's generally more balanced with that, using his hips a lot better.
Howie has done nothing but stay away from Parker Schmidt. On 1-2, we'll see what he does. He deals. Schmidt takes a bouncing ball, but not far away enough from the catcher Harrison, who got a leg on it. That is a huge play by the freshman catcher behind home plate.
Yeah, good job by Bear Harrison right there to keep that ball from getting all the way to the backstop. That would have easily allowed the runners to advance. Been pretty costly.
Heft on third, Rodriguez on second as the tying run. If Krizek scores, the ball game's over in the bottom of the ninth inning. The 2-2 from Howie. Swung on, grounded up the middle. Pamilia behind the base, boots it. One run scores. It's a 7-6 game in the bottom of the ninth on the second error of the inning by Pamilia.
Pamilia goes towards the bag and he catches the ball with his mitt and tries to flip it. And he flips it right at the feet of the second baseman, Napier, who had no chance at that ball. So gotten a little tighter here now with hot hitting Pinaro coming up. The lefty-righty matchup, I like us.
UNLV back within a run. Rodriguez on third, the tying run. Game-winning run in scoring position. Back-to-back errors by the shortstop. Set up Santino Pinaro in the bottom of the ninth inning. He swings to the first pitch, lines it through the right side of the infield. Scoring from third is Rodriguez. Krizek held up at third. We're all tied at 7 in the bottom of the ninth inning with one down.
Santino Pinaro coming through for the Rebels tonight. Big night for the left fielder. That's a absolute huge hit right there. Krizik being held up at third by Coach Higgins. That ball didn't get too deep out into right field. Schmidt was able to come up with that. Throw was up the line, but Krizik had already made his mind to get back to third base. Here, one out now. Infield will be drawn in.
As Chase Gallego stands in for the first time tonight. Game-winning run on third base. He watches a first pitch fastball right down the chute for a strike. Chase Gallegos, the Las Vegas native, looking to propel his hometown team to a win over St. Mary's. All tied at seven. One out, bottom of the ninth. The 0-1 pitch, foul down on play down the right field side. Looking at the dugout, they're jacked up for Gallegos. They thought that one might have been fair.
Yeah, he's one of the favorites in the clubhouse. It's just been a workhorse for the Rebels over the last couple years. Has to do, does whatever he's asked to do. Right now, they're looking for him to elevate something to the outfield.
He's behind nothing and two. As he swings and fouls this one down, that one caught Harrison on the inside of the leg.
Just got a piece of that one.
By the way, both runs scoring here in the ninth have been unearned thanks to a pair of errors by Pamilia at short. As of now, Howie with two unearned runs on the ledger in an inning and two thirds. Krizik on third, Schmidt and Pinaro behind him. They don't matter if Kriz is able to touch it up. Tied at seven, Gallegos behind nothing and two as Preston Howie sits and the right-hander deals. Gallegos chops it to short, Pamilia's got it. The throw to home is in time. The throw up the line at first, it's out of there. Scoring from third is Parker Schmidt. And thanks to a three error bottom of the ninth for St. Mary's, UNLV plays three unearned runs and walks it off in an 8-7 final.
Outstanding effort by the Rebels in the bottom of the ninth inning. Assisted by three errors by the Gales who have been cleaned for the night. Coming into the ninth inning, that ball wasn't hit very hard. Good relay to home. That throw by Harrison was down the line, right at the runner, over his head and the first baseman. Almanza being 6-2, still not able to come down with that. Rebels walk it off.
Rebels with the walk-off. Their first of the year here at Earl E. Wilson Stadium. And in an 8-7 final, improved to 11-8. And 7-3 here at Earl E. Wilson Stadium. UNLV down, never really out of it. They showed their resilience in the ninth, to be sure.
You know, absolutely. The baseball gods work in mysterious ways, right?
Yep.
Those three errors right there may be something that can propel these Huston Rebels to get some of that consistency we talked about pregame. The one thing you like about it is even with the errors, they put balls in play. They would have been easily able to go down, swinging at the plate, striking out, but they get the ball in play. Good things happen when the ball gets into the field.
Matthew Maloney with his fortuitous a win as he'll have all year. He improves to 2-0 as the Rebels walk it off against Preston Howie, who to his credit was really, really good. Three errors behind him in the ninth, but three unearned runs on the ledger. And for Howie, he drops to 1-2. The Rebels with 8 runs on 15 hits and just the one error. They left 8 men on, and for St. Mary's, 7 runs, 9 hits. The 4 errors, including 3 in the ninth, really bites. And they leave 6 men on base. Maloney to 1-0. Howie with the loss drops to 1-2. The Rebels winners in a game that took just under 2 hours and 50 minutes. Well, UNLV with an exciting 8-7 win to improve to an 11-8 record. St. Mary's dropped to 10-7 and 5-4 on the road. We'll see what UNLV can do for an encore. 2:05, a matinee series finale. This midweek non-conference showdown against WCC foe St. Mary's. Join Dan Dolby and I on the call tomorrow here from Earl E. Wilson Stadium. And for Dan Dolby and Sports Information Director Jake Rainey, along with everybody else here at UNLV Athletics, this is Matt Neverett saying thanks for tuning in. Back at it tomorrow, same place, different time. 2:05 first pitch from the Earl for tonight. Good night, everybody. I got the bounce side, left side. If you act bad, I'm
Okay, I'll wait. Yeah. I don't blame